on 27 Dustin, or thereabouts, so, which I thought was the original reason for the visit, a year ago, like six, eight months ago.
Yes, that was. You're not talking about, there's like a swale at the end just before you get to that big leaf pile, and that's been filled in a little bit with some chips or some debris or something. So there's no, the water doesn't have free movement from one side to the other.
No, I don't think it's the, I don't think it's the filling of a swale. It just seems to be filled in yard, but it kind of goes right up to standing water in between two trees on 27 Dustin to the right of the path. So we'll just continue to keep talking about it, and hopefully we'll be able to get some neighborhood cooperation on, because I think it will take a full neighborhood effort to manage that pile. So is there a motion to continue this to the next meeting? Or is there a further discussion, first of all?
We can just table it and see if they show up.
Okay. We don't need an official motion for that.
No.
All right. Okay. It's not 7:10, so some old new business.
We have a gentleman here from 118 Belmont Street that has a question about a piece of property we'd like to buy.
Do you mind sort of standing up and introducing yourself, just for the record? And
Adam Sperling.
Hello, Adam.
Some guidance that we would be able to put in an in-ground pool. There is wetlands behind the house, so I'm really looking again for some guidance, a little education on how that process might work, knowing obviously that might not happen on day one, but at least what the process would be like, what the setbacks would be required, and how it would go about it.
Are you calling up math?
No.
We need a refresher on exactly where 118
exactly
Belmont
where.
Is. Got our GIS system up.
So it is. Yeah.
That.
Yeah, it's good for that.
For orientation, Chuck, can you see if you can see where that water main's going through?
Yes, this is up in this area here. So let me just draw it back.
Yeah.
And you'll be able to see where.
Can you guys see
over
there?
Mm-hmm.
Ivy? Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Okay, see Charles.
The Belmont.
Belmont.
So pretty much in this area here.
Okay. Okay.
So the wetland is not part of
Timberdale.
It's
you're right.
Probably an isolated wetland.
Right.
Yeah, behind.
I can never remember being back in there myself.
My friend was.
That's
Do you have a satellite, Chuck? Do you have a so we can see the tree line?
Do anybody remember that wetland back there? I mean, it's totally
I don't remember it.
Seems to be totally surrounded by upland. And the highway.
You know, I don't think I've even done a site visit on that.
All right, Chuck, let's see if you can measure the area on that thing.
Oh, is it more than 500 feet, or is it?
Well, I'm trying to get an idea. I don't know.
Oh,
you can measure an area. Oh, yeah, I was just trying to be funny. You know?
Go ahead and,
wow,
go ahead and turn on the wetland area.
Yeah, well, it's huge. Yep. Yep, okay.
So it would be a jurisdictional.
Pass the test.
Okay. That answers one question.
You see what's, it's probably a pretty low area too, obviously, and
can you overlay the flood zone?
It doesn't come up, so there won't be one. I'm going to draw it back so we can see the flood zone.
Okay. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's wet or not. We'd have to go ahead and take a look, or somebody might have to take a look.
Right.
Or like relatively steep, not super steep, but there.
If there's a low depression along those back lot lines.
Like all the backyards are heading that direction, so I think it's just like snow and like rain in the spring.
It may be a basin.
The woman that lives there now said that it's wet for like 3 weeks, and then that's it, this time of year.
So you think this is.
That's scientific, but it's been up to 35 years.
That might explain some of these things in here.
So the process would be to determine, number one, if that's a wetland.
Okay.
And then number two, to determine where the wetland line is.
Right.
And then number three, a pool would have to be at least 35 feet from that wetland.
Right.
Can you refresh me? Isolated land subject to flooding. Is the isolated land in under the Reading bylaw more inclusive than the Wetlands Protection Act?
Yes. Under the Wetlands Protection Act, that isolated land is not subject to the constraints of the Wetlands Protection Act, but it is under the Reading bylaw. So
But isolated land subject to flooding, it's not the line of vegetation. It's you figure it out by rainfall and a hydrological calculation.
Right.
Is that the same with the Reading under the Reading bylaw?
No.
Is it by vegetation?
If it has vegetation, saturated soil, whether it's connected to a water body or not, it's jurisdictional under the bylaw.
So the edge of it is the vegetation.
Or the soil, or both.
Yeah. Okay.
So
it has a buffer.
From what it looks like on that map, it's probably not subject to the wetland, to the State Wetland Act.
Right.
It could be to the Reading. We don't know. We can't say for sure just sitting here.
Okay. So I guess now I'm looking just for some guidance as to what I would need to do, and I'm hoping to try to at least be in the process enough to know, forgetting where the pool might actually lie or the size of it, but at least get some comfort that I would be able to ultimately put a pool.
Have you already purchased the property?
We're under agreement, but not yet assigned purchase and sale.
Do you have access to the property under your purchase and sale?
I do, yeah.
There's one thing you could do, which would be the simplest, would be to hire a wetland scientist and go out there and look at that, offer their professional opinion, and then while they're out there, flag that wetland. That's one thing that you could do.
Okay.
Another thing that you could do, if the commission or the administrator had the time available, they could go by and take a look. And their opinion, just from a site visit, would not necessarily be definitive, but they could talk to you about it. But we don't want to.
But if a wetland scientist went, that would be what someone would be looking for. Define where
they would define that, and then we'd go out and either say we agree with it or we don't. And like 99 times out of 100, or 9 times out of 10 anyway, we agree with them. We might tweak it a little bit, but
right.
Very rarely do we have a total disagreement.
Okay, so once he does that, there's a 35-foot barrier, and you know, let's say that I'm with, you know, got 30 feet, not 35 feet. You know, is it sort of 35 foot is the line in the sand?
It is possible to get a variance from that 35 feet, but speaking candidly, we do grant variances if it's a small lot and it's a part of a house or access to a house or something that's necessary. It's less common that we grant a variance for a more casual structure, such as a patio, a basketball court, a hockey rink, or a pool.
Okay.
Just speaking.
Yeah, no, that's
in general history, not
is.
That doesn't necessarily apply to your property.
Yeah.
But historically, that's kind of been what we've done.
Okay.
But a variance, if you're going to request a variance, it's a different it's a notice of intent filing.
Yeah.
Which is a more involved filing.
Okay.
Which
so
means.
The situation is that would have 35 feet.
If you're beyond 50 feet, there's almost nothing you have to do. If you're between 35 and 50 feet, it's possible to file a more simple form request for determination of applicability.
Okay.
But if you're close to or definitely within the 35 feet, then as the chairwoman said, you have to file a notice of intent, you have to fill out the variance form, you have to pay a fair amount of money, was it $200 or something like that? What is it?
For the notice of intent?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's probably 110 state and 110 for this town.
Okay.
So we measured this out just using this tool, and he has about 55 feet between the wetland and the house here.
But keep in mind, that is a green area on a map. We really do not know if that's
right.
The wetland.
Right.
Yeah, and I stressed having a wetland scientist. And we've fallen into a problem following this line also. So if you work within the 35-foot zone or outside of it, it's about 20 feet to work with.
You mean 20 feet for a pool?
Yep.
20 feet from the back of the house to...
Yeah.
Or from the patio.
Wow.
To the 35-foot setback.
Yes.
That's kind of small for a pool.
Yeah.
Right. Now, there's a deck there that I wouldn't choose on my own to modify, but...
I mean, there is that L in the house. There might be more space there. You see it, Chuck?
Yep.
On the east side.
There's a 35-foot line.
Yeah, that's it's not a lot of space.
So what is it between the corner of that L and that red line?
24, 26 feet.
Yeah, that's
not a
tight.
Lot of space.
Why don't people like pools in their front yard?
So, another good thing.
Assume you're saying with a well design.
Yeah,
right.
Assume, yeah, but
right.
Again, we get carried away too, but we can't emphasize enough that green area is not the wetland. It's a strong indication there might be wetland in that area, but it is not the wetland.
Okay.
It could go either way. It could go close to the house or further away from the house.
Back, right.
Okay.
So that 86 contour line, you know, maybe 88 contour line might be somewhat in that area.
So
I think what... To the, you know, the $64 million question is, I understand how, you know, the size, you know, how big is this pool going to be, but if that pool can fit between the 35-foot and the house, it seems reasonable that an application, NOI application, would it would be allowed. With a variance, there could be a little more room. But the $64 million question is,
where is
it absolutely impossible to do? So is this a no starter for a pool? Does anyone see that
on
the commission?
If that wetland line.
So I'm hesitant to offer advice until we know that question. I think
yeah.
We presented you with the facts, the information.
Right.
I mean, if you, you know, like you were saying, Chuck, if you use the 86 contour as an indication of approximately where it may be, then that's probably.
Well, I think it's clear. If you can keep it above the 35-foot line, then there's room, but how big is that pool going to be?
Right.
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 And I mean, it seems like I would probably then be modifying the deck.
Yeah.
So having a 12-foot deck.
Right.
This
yeah.
gentleman over here brought his
right.
deck right to the edge of the house. So there's a modification
yeah.
going on. I think it's unlikely that that's not going to be somewhat of a wetland, but it could be possible.
Could be what?
Possible.
That's
I mean,
not a wetland.
That's not a wetland.
It could be.
That would be.
It could be.
Right.
And I know that there's a pine tree right there, but...
There is two large pine trees
I mean, if you
Pine trees are funny, they're facultative, they can either be wetland or out.
They can go in or out.
Right.
Now, the mapping suggests that it's probably.
Hey Chuck, I'm looking at lot.
There probably is, do you think?
28104.
It seems to me by looking at the map that it's somewhat likely, just looking at the colors on the map, it's somewhat likely. Can you zoom out, Chuck?
Yep.
On Chiquessa, it looks like somebody has a pool right up to the dot layer.
Let me go back to this layer here, it's easier to see.
See the 28-104.
Yeah.
Behind, sorry, down to the left. Yeah.
Yeah.
We don't know when that was built.
We don't know when that was built, or under what conditions it was built.
So, just from your experience, how quickly do you think I could find a wetland scientist to give me a...
2 days.
2 days.
Maybe one day.
Okay. They're pretty hungry.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right, Becky.
Why are you looking at me?
Are you a wetland scientist?
She is.
Yeah, but...
She used to be.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I couldn't do it for you anyway.
Right. A little conflict of interest.
You probably wouldn't have a quorum if you did.
No, we wouldn't.
Okay, so that can be done pretty quickly by me just locating a wetland scientist.
Yeah.
The other piece of information besides you getting it in real time on the land is to translate that also to a plan.
To a plan.
Right, right.
And that's kind of the next step that I'm not sure every wetland scientist is able to do. Sometimes
right.
it involves a surveyor. And
certainly for in order for you to understand the situation for us, you could get that wetland scientist to just take a tape and see how far it is from the
right,
house.
And at least I would
and
know
then reproduce that on your plot plan.
And
that would give us a good, strong
some comfort to know that I should be able to work through the process.
And if it's 80 feet, if that taping it from the head shows you it's 80 feet away, then that's probably adequate. But if it shows it's 4 feet away, that's probably adequate. But if it's your taping shows it's 34 feet away, then we'd have to survey.
Yeah. Right. Okay. So there needs to be a 35-foot buffer between where the pool ends and the wetland starts.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Any other guidance that...
Well, that includes the apron and a fence if you need it, so
right.
any kind of structure.
Right, yeah.
I think we went over a lot of this on the phone. I think they're saying the same thing, pretty much.
Okay.
Start by understanding where the line is.
Right. Okay, but if I have 35 feet, then I should be able to have some confidence that I could work through the process.
Well, if you have no space between 35-foot line and your hands.
In my house, correct. Right.
For your
pool
and appurtenances.
Okay.
Great. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
All right. Thanks for coming to us.
Good luck and welcome to Reading.
Thanks. Appreciate it.
Okay. Let's move on to the continued notice of intent. We'll reopen notice of intent for the general stormwater permit. Is George in for us?
George is sick.
Okay.
He reviewed the permit.
Anybody from engineering expected?
No. George reviewed the permit. Had no comments. Thought it worked.
Okay.
I looked at it. I'm good with it.
Can I reopen it? Can I reopen it and then we'll discuss
it? I can't remember if we closed it or.
Well,
minutes.
It's continued.
We continued it so we wouldn't start the clock.
So I'm just going to, for the sake of the public, so we're going to reopen the public hearing for DEP number 270-0638, the general stormwater general permit for the Reading Public Works Department. Engineering Division is reopened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 5.7. The hearing will be conducted in the following manner. The applicant will present the proposal. The commission will receive reports from its administrator and town departments. The commission will address questions and or comments to the applicant. The public will be given an opportunity to ask questions, which should be directed to the chair. Please give your name and address before your comments and or questions are presented. There is an attendance sheet at the front door, so if you haven't already, please sign in. And please introduce yourself, starting with Julie.
Julie Roger, recording secretary.
Rebecca Longley.
Jamie Vaughn.
Anika Scanlon, chair.
Brian Sullivan, vice chair.
Allison Steger.
Chuck Tarone, administrator.
Okay. So George isn't here. No one else is showing up. He didn't have any comments on it.
No.
Okay. I looked through it. I didn't see any major issues, just a couple little typos here or there, so I'm not even going to go into them.
I caught a few since I sent it out.
Yep.
So,
I like the way it stipulated what it doesn't cover. It made that clear and made the notifications clear. The only thing, maybe it was just the version I had, but the formatting didn't seem to organize. Maybe it was just my printout.
How's it look on
it
the?
Didn't seem.
How's it look on the hard copy?
Let me take a look.
The only thing that while you're looking at that, the only thing that has come up in the past, when a town gets a general permit, I start to get a lot of calls from homeowners and asking for us to get a certificate of compliance on this general permit. So would the commission entertain not having this recorded at the Registry of Deeds?
Yeah, I had a question about that.
I'm fine with it.
Because there was a piece in here about recording it, and I thought, record what? Like all the town streets and, you know, what would be recorded to start this permit?
Yeah, so.
Does this permit cover private land?
It covers easements.
I think the issue with recording, the reason why we record these things is so that it's available to the public, should, you know, in perpetuity. And so for us to require or to not require recording this, it wouldn't necessarily be a big deal, I don't think.
But if it's recorded, it has to be attached to a deed. So would it be the deed of?
You can record anything you want. You can record your signature if you want for no reason other than to record it. It doesn't have to attach it to anything.
But isn't it recorded at the Registry of Deeds?
It is. It is. But you can record any document you want for any reason. It doesn't have to be a deed. It can be anything.
Yeah, the old permit was recorded, so I don't know if it's in the recording page. But I can see the book.
I'm still trying to figure out why a private landowner would care.
Right.
So when the easement goes through someone's backyard, somehow it shows up. I've had a few phone calls of general permits. And they've given me the number. We look it up. It's a general permit, and they're asking for us to issue a certificate of compliance for their yard,
for
their
property. But when we issue notice of intent, order of condition for private parcel of land, that is noted on the deed that one was issued. And then the certificate of compliance has to be filed to cancel out that order of condition. But we would never enter on a parcel of private or public land, an easement on a private land, an action under this general permit. We would never go into their deed and enter that. Nobody would ever know anything was ever done on that parcel, because that general permit doesn't cover any specific parcel.
The only thing I can think they do is when they do the title research, they go into, they see that there's an easement.
They see there's an
going to the town of Reading. Then they do a search on town of Reading, and they look for anything open for the town of Reading for drainage. And then you see what I'm saying, how it comes up. They go, oh, this is open. We need to get this closed.
But there would never be anything open.
They would just
do their work on that easement under this permit.
Right, but the connection's being made improperly in that they're doing their own research. There's no connection in the deed that says, oh, you need to look at this drainage document.
Right.
You know, they do their own research now because the computer makes it easy. They don't have to go down and look through books anymore. But I think that's probably what's happening. I mean, it seems reasonable that that's what's happening. And that, you know, the title companies, they don't want to put any money, I mean, you know, the mortgage companies don't want to put any money into anything that doesn't have a clear title, so.
But that easement would be the issue. That would be the only thing on the deed.
Right.
That easy.
Exactly. Right. That would be the connection, I think.
Mm.
So if it's not recorded, then they can't find it. So it won't be an issue.
Right, that's what I'm saying.
Right.
So take that out.
So what's the language again? That they want struck? Of that recording?
I'm making that request. Just the requirement that this order of conditions is recorded at the registry of deeds. And it's because that there's been some problems in the past, getting phone calls and getting the closing attorney to understand that I can't issue a certificate. You know, these, the properties aren't even listed on the order of conditions.
Right, 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 right.
So how would the attorney ever know anything about it?
I don't know how it's happened. I just, there, it is a little crazy when you're refinancing now. I think Brian mentioned, I don't know how they're putting A and B together, connecting the dots, but.
It's all billable time.
I was just thinking the same thing.
It's all billable time.
I don't have,
There you go.
I mean, there's no way we can preemptively know which deeds are gonna be affected by this general permit, and the whole purpose is that it's a general permit, so I'm fine with striking that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't, you know, we have stipulations in here on how we're gonna get notified about the work and where it's gonna occur, and
And he still will get an order of conditions if he needs one.
And
a certificate of compliance if he needs one.
Yeah.
Just because it's not recorded doesn't make it not official. We ruled on it, so it's official, whether it's recorded or not.
Mm.
I'm fine with it not being recorded.
Are you thinking of a situation that we're gonna get in trouble? Speak now or forever? I mean, I'm thinking the drainage swale on.
Have we checked it with town council or anybody?
No.
I feel a whole lot more comfortable if we checked it with town council. Because it's in there, presumably, the previous one for a reason. And just because we don't know that reason doesn't mean there's a good one.
Was this, the template for this, and was this, a lot of this taken from the previous?
I just think it's part of a template. And it was left in there, and
yeah.
The policy commission before, everything was recorded. I asked George about it. Why do these things get recorded? Because we don't do it in Arlington, and we don't do it in Boxford. So anything for the town. It's because it ends up being a problem, and it costs money. So.
I mean, I think we record it because it's part of the order of conditions documentation that it should be recorded. It's part of the 488.
You just waived that.
Right, and we, right, that's what I'm saying. I mean, that's why we record it, because it's in the order of conditions, in the paperwork from DEP.
Mm.
Okay.
So, I can run it past town council. It seems that, you know, it's really up to you guys, whether it happens or not. It's like requiring something when your brother borrows money. It's like requiring some sort of legal paper.
Well, is there anything in the State Wetland Act or in our regulations that require all order of conditions to be recorded in the order of deeds, in the registry of deeds?
All is the word we're looking for.
For notices.
Everything's at, there's something in the regs, our regs, that say that everything's at our discretion. So.
Mm. You know.
No, well. The regs don't say everything to that discretion. The regs have some.
Well, let me find that spot. It said that it's up to the commission to. Let me just find what it says there.
This form 5 says this order of conditions must be recorded prior to the commencement of the work.
That's the state, right?
This is the state form. And it has to be reflected in the chain of custody for chain of title for all the affected properties.
That's in the NOI or the order of conditions?
This is in Form 5, I said 8A earlier, which is not that, it's Form 5.
Order of conditions.
Order of conditions, page 12.
Recorded.
12 of 12, it's not an optional page, so.
And the land court, so, which begs the question, if it must, according to the state form, be recorded at the registry of deeds, how does that get recorded? Does that get recorded for the individual project, each individual project as they're going through this?
No, this is the order of conditions.
Right.
This has to be recorded.
Right. I guess I don't understand the recording process that well, so, but as you're saying.
I suggest we pass it as is, and if George and Chuck want to check with town council, we can amend the order and remove that requirement. Does that make sense?
Sounds good to me.
Sounds good, yeah.
Yeah, I'm okay with that.
I don't care, but I don't think we're gonna ask. It's gonna get recorded, so that's fine.
So we've already voted on it, I believe. All we need to do is sign it. Close the hearing and sign it. So you want to answer the public comment?
Yeah, actually,
you can sign it.
Sure.
It's administrative, but this commission may have a different opinion.
Pardon?
Since I didn't vote on it, I don't sign it, right? Or do I sign it?
It's up to you.
You're here and you can vote on it.
It's
an
administrative act, just like approving the minutes. But
can I just?
There is enough people with.
Yeah, you don't have to sign if you don't feel comfortable.
Are there any questions about the townwide stormwater maintenance permit from the public? No? Anybody want to comment on that? Okay. Hearing none. Where are we at with motions?
Now, if one of us is absent, we have to sign.
It looks like you have some corrections.
really, just add a yes.
Add some changes.
Just minor.
Just say as amended and hand me the sheet.
Yep.
Whoa, I'd like to know what it is.
It is, it's just really, really minor typos.
Like what?
Like. Subject for and there was one part here, the advance notice to the Conservation Commission or administrator under special conditions 7 below is not required. It says not requires, so I just changed the S to a D, so it's just provided that such work is conducted in a manner that prevents the discharge of sediment, trash, debris, and other contaminants into any wetland resource area for the following day-to-day maintenance projects. One thing I was wondering about, Chuck, with this townwide permit is there's a lot of mention of the wetland resource area that covers, jurisdictionally, that covers streams and...
Yes.
Yes, okay. Because it's a wetland. Okay.
The furthest you can go into the streams on this permit is 20 feet, 25 feet.
Okay.
And that's when he asks us. But it's
very specific.
Under the order.
Gotcha. Can I just give you my typos here? No, I'm just passing that to Chuck. Thank you. Okay, I will entertain a motion to close the
hearing.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. Okay, next on the agenda is the request for determination 2015-3, 10 and 12 A Street, map 23, lot 184 and 185, Boston Gas Company, DBA National Grid. What's DBA stand for?
Doing Business As.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So I assume you're representing, so please introduce the project and.
Sure. My name is Amanda Neville. I work for Conoco Engineers and Scientists. We are an environmental consultant for National Grid. So Boston Gas Company is proposing extending an existing main that is on A Street to service houses number 10 and 12. There are wetlands along the street there, so we will be within the 100-foot buffer zone, I think maybe as close as 25 to 30 feet. But the majority of the work is done within the roadway. They saw cut the pavement out 2 to 3 feet, you know, I'm sure you guys have seen this, but they'll take a mini excavator, they'll take out the soil, lay the new pipe, they'll reuse any of the soil that they can. Anything else will be swept up, put in an on-site truck and taken off-site. So the only portions that will not be in the street are the actual service connections to the house. So we'll be going from a 4-inch plastic pipe in the street to a 2-inch plastic pipe that will extend from the roadway to the side yards of both residences. So it's much more minimal disturbance in the side yards there. So they will reseed, loam, do whatever they need to do to make sure that the property owners are happy with the restoration. So we will be putting silt sacks in all the catch basins along the roadway, as well as straw wattles or hay bales of stakes all along the roadway between the edge of pavement and the wetland, and we'll probably horseshoe it around the end of the excavation near number 10 is at the end of the street there. You know, and bring it up to the house so that everything is completely cut off from the wetland that's there.
Okay.
So.
How deep is the, what's the invert of the gas main in the street?
The trenches are about 3 feet deep, 3 to 4 feet depending on what they encounter. But usually about 3 feet.
And have you already marked the other utilities in the street?
I don't know if they've done that yet.
How long will this project, do you anticipate it would take?
It's only about 150 feet of main, maybe, and then the service connections to the house, so maybe a week.
Okay. I'm looking at your plan that shows the erosion control.
Yes.
And I know there's a house back here. Is the erosion control going to be taken down to allow the vehicles to
we'll have it in there just if they're working, just to prevent soil from
during
the
project.
But what they'll probably do is they'll do the trenching in the street first, and then they'll backfill and they'll completely repave that area.
Yeah.
So we'll be able to remove them at that time, because then all we'll be doing is the service connections to the house.
Okay.
So they can just line the erosion controls along the trench in the side yard.
Gotcha.
It's all going to be open cut. There's going to be no directional.
Nope, it's open cut. They'll just soft cut it. It's about 2 feet wide, maybe.
So I was wondering if you had talked to the engineering department lately about actually doing this job.
I have not. I don't know if the representatives from Boston Gas Company have.
Well, I'll update the commission. So this project came in very late. And they intend to repave the roads down there. So George told me that this is a non-starter. So I'm not sure if you want to check on it or that, but they're not going to allow you to do this project from what I'm hearing.
Did they pave it yet?
No.
If they can get out there before they pave, they should be able to do it, right?
Yeah, I don't know. Does that ever happen with your projects?
I honestly have no idea.
Yeah,
That's what
I'm hearing.
She can coordinate, and they're pretty quick.
Yeah, I can get in touch with the engineer for this job, you know, in the morning, and he can.
Yeah,
you don't have to put it out to bid or anything. You already have your.
Yeah, this is right from Chris Cole.
Signed up, right?
Yeah. I mean, they like I said, normally they. when they're anticipating starting the project, that's when they'll send plans over to the town, just in my experience on a lot of these projects. So there's probably a pretty high chance that.
Well, they've been out there for 2 weeks already doing work on ivy and all the little letters, so.
Well,
the townhouse?
Yeah.
Clause in our order of conditions, I don't know if it's in the RDA or not, that they have to get all of their applicable permits and approvals.
Yeah, I.
And let's just make sure we have that in here, but let's don't hold them up.
Right, I didn't know what,
Yeah.
what the result of that was. As a matter of fact, I was kind of surprised after talking to, George and Chris that it wasn't withdrawn, because they just said there's no way they're gonna issue that permit. But, not to surprise you, but that's what I heard.
Yeah.
So check with them.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, we're just passing along
what
we know.
Town, as long as it's not paved and they get in there before it's paved.
Yeah.
That they could do it, because after it's paved, unless you wanna repave the entire street, I don't think it's gonna happen.
And that's what I told them, I was asking if there was any way that this could work, so.
Yeah, or they could leave that stretch of A Street as one of the later paving jobs, some sort of coordination. But that's out of our hands, as Jamie said, so. Any other questions about the permit as proposed?
I think it's simple, I think it's.
I do too.
Fine.
Yeah.
I move we issue a negative determination for the extension of the gas main on A Street as per filing by National Grid.
Okay, I'll second. All those in favor? Okay, so,
So I didn't print this one out, but I will go and get it, probably when we have some, we can sign at the end of the meeting.
Okay, so we have some paperwork we can sign, and I guess that's it. So good luck following up with engineering.
Thank you.
And,
Sorry, Amanda, yeah.
No, I guess that's out of my hands too.
Yeah, I.
So I'll notify the engineer in the morning and have him call.
Okay.
And
see what happens.
Okay. Thanks for coming
great.
In.
Thank
you.
Guys. Have
a good
night.
Gas is easy. If we're still on.
Oh, yeah. Doesn't have to be level.
Well, day tomorrow, put it in.
Yeah.
Doesn't
yeah.
Then freeze.
No.
Okay. Let's.
Yeah, end up here, water main is a different story.
That's a different story.
So at this point, we're going to open the public hearing for Notice of Intent 270-0641, 306 Main Street, Map 11, Lot 266, Simpson. So that is now being opened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Chapter Section 5.7. The hearing will be conducted as follows. The applicant will present their proposal. The commission will receive reports from their advisors and administrator and departments. The commission will address questions and or comments to the applicant. The public will be given an opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair. An attendance sheet is being circulated. Actually, it's at the door. Please sign in. And at this point, Chuck, would you please introduce yourself?
Chuck Taroni, the conservation administrator.
Allison Stager.
Brian Sullivan, Vice Chair.
Anika Scanlon, Chair.
Jamie Mullen.
Rebecca Longley.
Julie Roger, Recording Secretary.
Okay.
I'm Jack Sullivan. I'm the engineer on the project, and I'm here with the owner of the site, Brandon Simpson.
Even? Chuck, do we need the light off still, or?
No. Let's start out with the simplest thing. I received, so I don't know if you know, me and Brandon went back and forth a couple times on what's going on with these things.
Yeah.
Certified mail receipts usually come with green cards, but I don't know how this happened. I guess it can happen. But what I'm gonna need is, just to make sure that we finish this out, is the tracking confirmation on ups.com. So I think you can get that for all these, because I'm not sure what these mean, because.
Did you call the?
Well, I went down.
Yeah, they told me to talk to the postmaster.
Yeah, yeah. So they're the one that said you can get some sort of tracking.
Right.
But
what are you looking for, Chuck?
So we don't have green cards for these. I think
that
Grant
shows that it was mailed though, for sure.
Right. It was stamped.
With the stamp. See the stamp?
Right.
I see that. But when I'm looking at this in 4 years, it's not gonna say it to me. It's gonna say there's a green card somewhere. So I want the confirmation page.
So then they're gonna have to track every single one of those, is what you're saying.
That's what I'd like.
Okay.
And
then it'll be
yeah.
a printout and you can staple it to it.
Yeah. That's what Kristen and Sergi do.
That's fine. And the
yeah.
only other thing I can add is Brandon signs an affidavit of service that he submits
right.
to the notice of intent saying everyone was notified. So I agree you can provide that, but also he signed as the owner saying he did provide that as well as a fallback.
Right. Simple.
Simple.
Okay.
Right.
Feel
Brandon.
Free to... anything else, Chuck?
Do you have any overheads, Chuck? Or?
I don't.
Okay. Well, I'll refresh everyone's memory on this. It's been a while. Brandon's the owner of Pizza World. He's looking to develop the site to put his pizza business in at 306 Main Street. It was a former gas station site. We came before you probably a year ago. With a similar plan, but different in some sort. Same building footprint, same general idea for parking lot movements. What we've done now is we made some changes as far as stormwater goes. Stormwater management's changed somewhat. We were proposing rain gardens before, but now we're actually eliminating some of the on-site curbing. When we met with CPDC, we were looking for a waiver of some of the curbing, and if they said if it was curbing is required if it's part of your stormwater management system for performance, but if it was a case where there'd be sheet flow out to some sort of crushed stone area that would feed into a rain garden, that the curbing could be eliminated. And the reason we went to them is Brandon had received prices on the proposed work. They were way higher than we expected. So he called me saying, we got to figure out something to try to reduce my costs. And we kind of took 6 months off, and then we came back, and this is where we're at now. In the interim, though, where this is on Route 28, it's state highway layout, we have received Mass DOT approval for the curb cuts and the utility connections. So those are two big hurdles that we've overcome. The site, to refresh everyone's memory, it's going to be a two-story building. The first floor will be the pizza shop. The second story is just going to be for storage. There'll be 18 parking spaces. There'll be a entrance only on the northerly side of the property and an exit on the southerly side of the property. There will be a dumpster. There'll be a bike rack. We're trying to encourage, we don't know how much this will do, but we provided walkways and movements on site for pedestrians to service the establishment. As I stated, for the stormwater management, there'll be three rain gardens. I have a detailed grading plan showing how water will run off from the paved areas into those rain gardens. And ultimately, there'll be an emergency overflow mechanism out to the rear of the property, and it'll run out to the BBW.
Can you use your little laser pointer to point at the rain garden?
Sure. Okay. I have a small rain garden at the front entrance, right here.
What sheet are you on, Jack?
I'm on sheet 4 of 10.
Okay.
Okay. So just in front of each rain garden, there's a pre-treatment area. There's a crushed stone. It's 2 feet wide by various lengths, but runoff will come off the parking lot. There'll be some pre-treatment in the crushed stone level apron. It'll go into a rain garden. The rain gardens are typically 18 inches deep, and there's a hooded overflow. So when the water reaches a certain point, water will go into the hooded overflow and then out into a pipe to the next rain garden. There's a second rain garden right here. And then there's a large rain garden at the back of the property. And then I have roof downspouts
And all three rain gardens are connected by this overflow pipe?
Correct, correct. And then at the back of the rain garden, I have an emergency riprap level spreader overflow. But all this has been sized to meet DEP stormwater standards. I did a detailed analysis for the 210, 25, and 100 year storm event, and the post-development rates of runoff are less than the pre, with all and peak rates of runoff. What did I want to add on that?
So how much do you need to excavate to install these rain gardens? You said they're 18 inches deep.
They're 18 inches deep. I have to, on my construction detail, they'll actually be excavated probably like 2.5 feet down. I have some details here. But there's 18 inches of growing medium, and then there's 12 inches of gravel beneath that. So that's 30 inches, so at least 2.5 feet down. I have some good construction details. I've used them in the city of Lowell loves rain gardens now. I've done a lot. I've had really good success with them on some commercial and residential applications. So this is the basic detail that I've used on those sites. I actually did one, it didn't come before this commission, but it was the dentist, Dr. Ravens, behind Burger King.
Oh, there's one there?
There's one there.
He didn't need a wetlands permit.
He didn't need a wetlands permit. But I did deal with Chuck a little bit on it. It wasn't within any jurisdictional areas, but where it was a rain garden, Chuck did have some comments on like operation and maintenance. But it wasn't something that I had to file an RDA or notice of intent for. It's high and dry there.
Where is it? I might stop by and take a look.
If you take a look, you know where they put the addition, then they expanded their parking lot?
Yeah.
If you go to the back of the parking lot, there's a rain garden back there.
Is it completed?
It's all complete. So take a look. It's about 18 inches deep.
Cool.
It's mulched. All the plantings are in place. But this would be similar to that. Does not have any of the hooded overflows. I have an overflow because out towards Reading Municipal Lights property, there was like a 12 or 18 inch drain, and I have an overflow with a connection out to that drain. But it'll be a similar look. And we wanted to pick something that was low maintenance. He didn't want to get into storm scepters and infiltrations, especially, you know, this is a 21E. He's with a 21E. I don't want to dig any more than I have to. It seems like this will work.
Is there an under drain?
There is an under. There's no under drain.
No under drain.
No under drain.
But there's an overflow, but no under drain.
Correct.
And in your experience, in your previous installs, you haven't had an issue with water ponding?
No.
So what would happen if the groundwater level comes up so you don't get any infiltration, then that overflow will work?
Right. I'm still, the bottom of my rain garden is at least 2 feet above
it
the
still
high groundwater
okay.
table. So even in your high water season, the groundwater table won't affect the capacity in the rain garden. But as that rain garden fills up, let's say we have a real heavy storm, the water will accumulate in the rain garden, but when it hits a certain level, it'll go into the overflow.
So the controlling factor would be the porosity of the soil under your
correct.
13 inches of
correct.
Crushed stone.
And I assume 30 minutes per inch for a rain out there. The soils aren't the greatest. It's all fill out there. So by him digging out an additional 2.5 feet below the rain gardens and putting in gravel and everything else, it is a measure of safety with that. We did, where we submitted a year ago, we did have a lot of, you know, we've been in front of CPDC, we've been in front of this commission before. We submitted a new filing. Some of the changes from the last plan, which are improvements, there's a patio area now out in front of the restaurant. Previously, that was going to be a rain garden.
Yeah.
CPDC, they like the outdoor seating out front, it'll be fenced. So that was a change we made. I added some concrete bollards at the dumpster locations, also at the rear door. Where
not the, granite like we have in downtown?
No, those are bullseyes. And then also, there's an AC unit. I put two ballards there as protection as
good
well.
Good idea.
One thing that Chuck asked for at the last meeting, which I was not at, is we're installing a solid 6-foot-high white PVC fence along the limit of work line for this project. And that's just to make sure, you know, if anything went to blow, it would stay on the site and not blow into the wetland area.
Will there be a gap under that PVC pipe?
Yes.
Or fence?
Yeah, we'll leave it 4 inches high so critters can move back and forth while like a little throat.
No, it's an incredulous.
DEP did issue a final number for this project, but in the comments it said still under review. And when are we meeting with CPDC, Brandon?
Supposed to be May 4th. I think it bumped it 2 weeks afterwards.
So
May 18th, I think somewhere.
CPDC later May. And I just received some comments from planning today, but I haven't had a chance to review them. But Brandon did look at me, said they were relatively minor.
Okay.
But we haven't received engineers' comments back on drainage or anything.
Do you have any idea of the footprint of the gas station that was there 25 plus years ago?
I do from aerials, but that's about it.
What's your question? I remember where it was.
You do?
Yeah, I do.
I remember where it was. I don't remember how big it was.
It was a small building back here.
Yeah, tiny.
It was very small in the back left corner.
No, it was less than
25.
It's been a long time, but the building was very,
15,
very small. 10, you know,
was
you
tiny.
Basically just go up and there was someone in there and just slip your money to them. But it
was, it was
probably
small.
A building like 12 by 20.
It was,
tiny. What about
it was like a shed.
What about the paved area?
I show the paved area on the existing conditions plan. So I was able to get that because when they went to, originally they were going to try to redevelop the site and put in like some sort of Cohen Farms or something came. There was a detailed survey done and it showed the limit of pavement, which I show because I'm taking credit. The majority of the site is a redevelopment project because we're within that footprint, but a small portion of the parking is outside of that area.
All right. Because that pavement now is it's still there. You can hardly tell.
You can tell
it's,
because
there's
stuff scrolling
little bit
through
of it.
And they removed some of it too. They removed
right,
some
they
soil.
Put some wells
yeah.
in, and they excavated
yeah.
some soil.
Right, so it would be tough to see.
They excavated soil, they pumped out tons of groundwater.
The site is still, I think that they're monitoring the site,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
They still are, right?
Yeah,
right.
Still
phase four.
Yeah. So I basically tried on the existing conditions plan to show where that limit was.
Yep.
Just, to give the commission an idea where it is.
I have a question about any thoughts as to where snow storage might be put once it's developed?
That was the talk I had with Brennan. We really.
It's a challenging site.
Yeah, he's going to have to enter into some sort of contract to have snow removed from the site. There's very little. Can't put them in the rain gardens. And in fact, by the rain gardens, I'm showing a wooden guardrail to be placed just to, you know, so no one drops in. We would not have a curbing.
Mm-hmm.
I had to put something to prevent vehicles from going in. But there's really not much
area in the rain
at
garden.
All. I mean, behind the dumpster, there's going to be a little bit of green space, but that's very small. And all the other areas are part of my stormwater management.
I wonder if you could get some storage at the bank drive through next door.
Well, we had talks about even trying to park over there.
Yeah.
Like a shared, you know, how the town encourages shared parking, but trying to deal, you know, they're out of like Nebraska or something that, you know, it's the headquarters.
There is shared parking there. If you ever go to Starbucks, you have to park in the bank.
Yeah.
There is shared. It's true.
The town manager said people will park there and come over to the site to get a formal agreement.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I just as a general comment, I really like the rain gardens and the crushed stone. I think it's a pretty big improvement over what was submitted before. I think the plan looks pretty good at this point. I didn't have that many questions. I don't know if anybody else had looked at it.
I have one question. This request to waive the filing fee, I'm not sure I understand it. Can you explain it?
Well, I withdrew.
Did we give you your money back?
No, no, as far as for this notice of intent, this
yeah.
meeting, no. I submitted the check and I wrote a letter to Chuck. He advised me to write, and when I withdrew, I didn't realize 100% what I was doing. I didn't want to waste your time because I knew this was going to take a long time. At every corner I was coming, there were more things popping up for me. So I withdrew from CPDC and conservation.
So this is a new filing then?
Yeah, this is a new filing.
And what you're asking is not have to pay the fee because you paid it before. Is that?
Yes, yes.
Is that the deal?
Yeah.
I think it's reasonable.
I do too.
Yeah.
That's what I thought happened, but I couldn't quite
mm-hmm.
get that out of this. Out of this number.
I think what added to his confusion too is when CPDC said he could withdraw and that they wouldn't make him pay a new fee when he comes back, because he was telling him how he had to really look at his finances. So I think that played into your mind a little bit too.
Again, I'm just a pizza man, so I'm at least.
Have we already spent that money, Chuck?
Yeah. Well, DEP won't give him his money back, but we can certainly reimburse him for our share.
Mm-hmm.
So he will have to
They actually asked. They actually asked, and their answer was pound sand. So.
Should we take a vote on that one?
Sure.
Yeah. All right. Yeah.
Have it.
Yeah.
Oh, you mean
a vote on the fee.
Oh, okay.
A vote on the fee.
I'm gonna open the portion of the fee that we can waive, the town portion of the fee for this submittal.
All right. I'll second. All those in favor? Okay. Any questions from the public at this point? No? No? Any questions from other people on the commission?
I did have some questions. I did wanted to go over the dumpster storage area and the operational maintenance plan for after it's built. So I always like to see on the operational maintenance plan more detail than you have here. And I don't know what's going to happen tonight, but if there's time, I'd like to make some comments on it and send it to you, and maybe you can just add those in, just like at the dental place. And then on the dumpster storage area, is that enclosed?
Yes.
And it's again, it's a vinyl or PVC around that?
Yeah, it's got a. It's.
No, it's not gonna be PVC. It's gonna be
wood frame.
It'll be wood frame, same siding as on the building. So three sides, and then I'll have the double gates, and then we'll have the bollards. Which you had requested the last time we were at the meeting.
Sure. Did you think about putting bollards at the back? So I don't know what kind of dumpsters you have, but if it's the kind they pick up?
It's going to be, I have to do a design. Part of the comments of CPDC was, design where the dumpsters are going to be, and they're going to be 2-yard roll around dumpsters.
Okay.
So what they're going to do is they're going to open the gate, they're going to roll out, dump it. So it won't be one of those ones where they come in with a fork, because I know early in the morning they're going to veer left and right and knock it over. So that was. I got to work on that, a drawing for them also, so I can send that also. But that's the plan with the rubbish.
I just want to make sure that the dumpsters have covers on them, because if anything gets out of there and it gets into the wetlands, there's no opportunity. I don't know if you have in here that you'll walk around in the spring cleaning up in back of the fence, but that would probably be a comment that I would make.
Okay.
Is there going to be a gate in that fence, or it's going to be completely enclosed in the back?
Completely enclosed in the mm-hmm. back. The only gate will be on the front side.
So that, is it necessary to have that 4-inch space at the bottom? Because that could be a spot where.
Not in the dumpster. The dumpster.
No, 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 at the fence in the back.
I think usually the commission likes to see that.
Yeah, we do.
Well, you want to attract animals into the dumpster area?
Well, this isn't the dumpster. This is the fence along the back. The dumpster will be all the way to the ground.
Well, it would just bring animals from in the back straight up into the restaurant area. I don't, I mean, it says animal passage, that could be left and right, that doesn't have to be like across town.
Mm.
So that's an area, unless the grass grows high in back of it, that's gonna get some things underneath.
I'm
possibly over.
I think that should happen.
Like trash is what I'm talking about.
Right.
I'm talking about trash, Jimmy. Yeah, I'm just going underneath. It's bringing it up, you know. I would like to see it more sealed.
Part of the maintenance plan can be a periodic inspection for trash on the reverse, on the back side of the fence.
There's no gate, yeah, but I guess you could walk around. Is there the ability to walk around that gate from one side to the other?
Is it on the back side of it?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think if I go around behind the dumpster that side of it, I'm sure I can get behind the, I mean, the only other thing is, I mean, does it have to be, the 4 inches, does it have to be the whole length of the fence? Can it be like maybe a, I don't want to say chicken wire, but something, and then leaving an opening that increments, like closer to the dumpster, but the dumpster, there has a cover, they have flip over covers.
Yeah.
The fence will be taller than the dumpsters.
Yeah.
And I know wind comes, I know, you know, things move around, but yeah, I mean, as far as if there's trash out there, I'm going to pick it up.
I ran into this before, and Jack was actually on that project with a grease trap. Is there some special grease trap situation you guys are doing on this one?
Or inside underneath the sink.
What was that one we were dealing with?
That was the same bistro.
So there's nothing like that?
No, it was Anthony's roast beef. They had an outside gas grease trap. They moved it inside, but it was one that somehow had been left open during a rainstorm. And
right.
Oh, right.
Remember
right.
that one?
Yeah.
It had like
yeah.
a removable
yeah.
barrel,
yeah.
too,
yeah,
or
so
something like that.
Yeah, so then they came up with a special thing on the inside, and it's all
yeah.
working out.
But that was a grease storage container for used grease, mm-hmm. wasn't
Correct.
It? Yeah,
Correct.
Yeah, not to be confused with the grease trap
be,
for the drain.
That'll be part where the dumpster is, the enclosed area, though. That's where my...
You're going to put grease in that area then?
Yeah.
There'll
be a container for that. So as far as tipping it over, it'd be very, you know, no one's going to go tipping it over.
No, it's just the runoff after several months of using that, or several years, it has that grease on the ground.
Well, I have barrels that get taken out each time. They don't pump it out. They take out the barrels themselves. So they get replaced probably every 2 or 3 weeks.
So the grease goes into the barrel inside, then you take the barrel and put it in the dumpster enclosure?
No. I have a 55-gallon drum. So when I take, we're talking about fryer later. When I take that, I have a big container, and then I dump it into that 55-gallon drum, and then they come and take it every like 2 or 3 weeks.
Oh, so the drum resides inside that dumpster enclosure?
It'll be in there, yeah.
And you take the fryer out and dump it into the...
Yeah, I have a bucket I dump the fryer later goes into, and then I bring it up back and dump it into the 55-gallon drum.
And if any still, there's a concrete pad under the dumpster, right?
Yeah, and I actually use a shortening, so it actually solidifies, so... Except for maybe, you know, summertime where it's 90, but still
yeah.
kind of solid, but majority of the year it's solid.
So I assume the finished grade of the pavement is going to be pretty flat.
Yes.
I see some arrows here on the drainage grading plan, so it's 2.4 of 10. It says 1%, 3%. 5%. Are those the grades?
At the back of the lot, it's basically 1%.
1% to the south?
Yeah. It towards the front of the lot, you know, coming in off the street. All the drainage, what MassDOT liked is I'm not putting any drainage out to the state highway.
That's why you have a steep,
that's why it's a little
steeper
bit
grade
coming
right
in,
at the entrance.
It levels out, and
yeah.
we're basically 1%.
Yeah.
And just to back up to what Chuck was saying, I'm fine with any comments he needs to add. We need to continue tonight anyways, because we have to see what CPDC wants from us, and I'll gladly incorporate comments that he wants to see.
Okay.
And typically, like the way if trash did blow, it's really probably going to collect in the rain garden, or we're going to have landscape plantings along here too, and then we have the measure of the fence as well, so...
Now, I'm having trouble understanding where the fence is going to be? Is that gonna be between the rain garden and the 25-foot line, or is there, am I missing? Which fence are you talking about? Are you talking about the silt fence, the construction, the erosion control? That's the fencing you're talking about? Or are you talking about permanent fencing after construction?
Yes. Right, so it's going basically right at the 25-foot no disturb zone.
That's both the temporary and the permanent.
Correct.
Okay. Is there a schematic?
So to make sure I understand, you're not asking us to approve this because it might change based on CPDC?
Right, and so that's why Chuck has some comments he wants me to put into the operation and maintenance, and DEP said it's still under review, so I'm fine not closing it, because if CPDC does want some changes, and I close with you, then I'd have to come back in for like a minor change or.
Right.
I'd rather just continue, see what they need, make my changes, and then come in.
They have seen this plan, or they.
They have, but we haven't had a public hearing on it. We did, you know, 8 months ago.
Are they comfortable with this plan as far as we know? I mean, if they have a chance to look at it?
Yeah, when the comments that they've made, some of the things I think, you know, just basically, you know, it's the fence material, it's the air condition, you know, as far as when they were looking at the building itself, you know, they had a few cosmetic changes, flower boxes and stuff like that, but as far as, you know, how it looked, the only thing they're going to ask about, and they did, was the granite, why there doesn't go all the way around like it, you know, previously had. I think that was one of the more major concerns.
So they're comfortable with this concept of no curbing and the rain garden?
Well, as far as no curbing, no, they made a comment, why are we removing so much vertical granite?
I think George and Boris will be fine with it. He was at the CPDC meeting that we had way back, and the idea on the curbing is they said if it's not part of your stormwater system, if it's not meant to channel water to like a catch basin or something like that, he's okay with it.
Let me tell you my concern. My concern is that I think I'm pretty comfortable with this, and I haven't heard any other opposition. If now CPDC comes in and says, no, we have to have curbing and we need 4 more parking spots, and then you change this, we might not be able to approve that. But if we have a feeling that they're okay with this concept, that would be good to know.
My parking layout will not change, Jamie. They're not gonna, the parking scheme I have is maxed out. If you can see, I stacked some parking for employees. I can't do much more for parking. If anything, they'd say, can you take some out, which we really don't wanna do, but.
Yeah, you guys are over what you need for the tables and seats.
We're over for what we need.
Well, I'm wondering if.
But I could not, I wouldn't be able to add more spaces, and if they wanted curbing put back in, the layout would remain the same. I'd just have to put curbing back in and put in some catch basins. I think they're gonna be fine without the curbing. There still is some curbing in areas where I need curbing, like along this side.
Mm-hmm.
Water's running off, and I'm using that curb line as a berm to channel water back. So I honestly think they'll be okay, but I don't know until I go.
Let me just.
But we're leaving it open anyway, so.
Yeah. Well,
so,
let me just think out loud or talk out loud or
go ahead.
Whatever the saying is. If we approve this plan, and then this plan is taken before CPDC, and they say CONCOM's happy with this plan, they approve it, it might make them more comfortable. And if they do make some minor tweaks, we can come back for a minor change. That's what I'm thinking. Because somebody has to approve it first, either us or CPDC.
I don't think
so.
we're going to do is going to do anything.
Yeah.
I mean, I think they're going to do whatever they want.
That was kind of my opinion, too.
I
don't know.
I think they're
going to
do whatever they want.
Sometimes they defer to us.
Not lately.
If they don't want to make a hard decision, they'll defer to us.
Yep.
What's the harm in waiting? I mean, you have no problem with that.
I don't have a problem. And typically, like what I do with this commission, if I go into CPDC, I'll say, we met with CONCOM. Couple minor little things. We didn't want to close it out until we got feedback from you. They seemed pretty comfortable with the design and the the drainage and everything else, and then I get their comments, and then I come back to you. Either way, I'm comfortable if we close tonight and we come back for a minor change, but I'd be back anyways for the minor change.
Right.
They're gonna probably change
something.
But the overall design, they've seen this before. The parking layout, the building hasn't changed. It's really, we're getting down to the nitty-gritty, the look of the building, some plantings here and there.
Have they approved your sign?
The what?
The sign of the building?
The signs.
Sign.
We don't need to.
All the signs, I'm very minimal, just raised lettering and, you know.
We don't need to get all into that, but.
They pay a lot of attention to the sign.
Yep, signs are a big deal.
Most of our meetings gonna relate on signs and lighting.
Yeah. So at this point, any more questions from commission?
Yeah, a couple more questions.
Yep, go ahead.
Did we see a lighting plan for this? What's that? Did CPDC review that?
Yeah, they have a photometric plan.
You want a copy of it?
You have one and we didn't get that?
Sure.
Oh, I was just wondering, what's it like on the other side of the fence? Drop right down?
Not over there, on the other side of the fence. Why don't we provide?
Yeah, why don't you get us that?
I'll get you one. They made a comment, there's a little spillover into Bank of America and into the Grace Towing there, the Enterprise. Spills over a little bit. We're trying to work with, you know, dropping the poles or something, but there's only three lights, one on the south, north, and in the back.
And then you have pavement in the 35-foot zone, and was there a variance request with this order?
No, but what I wanted to, I think I have a way that could sell this to the commission that works well. On the existing conditions plan, you can see where we talked about earlier, Jamie, where that building was before. There's about 400 square feet of pavement that existed inside of the 35-foot no structure zone, and a portion of it was also within the 25-foot no touch zone. With our proposed plan,
how many square feet? What did you just say?
About 400 square feet. And then let me get to the site. On the site plan, this parking space, we have a small area, and I'll go through the total, but we have a small area here. There's a small area here for this movement, for the fire trucks. And then for this parking space, there's a small area. And when I added all those areas up within the 35, we're at like 50 square feet.
I like it.
So originally we had 400, and some of that was, again, inside the 25.
Yeah, I don't think the variance is required.
I like it.
I think technically we should get one. I mean, you are within the 35 foot.
Okay.
I think you can go through the variance. I think we need it.
Okay.
As a document, as a letter.
Is that 50 feet?
He needs to.
Within the previous 400 feet, or is it a different
not
area?
Some wasn't.
Not all of it. It's not all in the same footprint area.
So I think you can do the variance quite easily. I mean, the one sticking point is that overwhelming public benefit. I think redeveloping the site might be considered
that's one.
It should be pretty easy, and it's just paperwork, really.
And rain gardens.
Well, that's a private benefit, unless he puts it on the medium strip in the middle of Main Street.
Well, the mitigation removing 350 square feet of.
Well, if it's on his own property, that again, that's private. We need an overwhelming public benefit.
No, there is a public benefit because the runoff from that 350 square feet doesn't go into the stream directly.
My understanding of how that worked was you can't get a public benefit on your own property, but if that's not the case, then that's fine. I just didn't know that.
The mitigation. Because you have the three conditions are mitigation, look at alternatives, and
overwhelming public benefit. Yeah.
So the public benefit is redeveloping 21E. The mitigation is removing 350 square feet of paved area.
Yep.
And the alternatives are, we've been working with you and come up with a design that minimizes encroachment into the
So it's just, again, it's just paperwork, so I think that would be pretty easy.
I can put together a variance request and cite the three sections and give answers, just.
We'd like to add that to the record.
That's fine, just.
Any other questions from the commission or from the public? No? Okay, hearing none, is there a motion to continue to the next meeting, which is, I don't know when the next meeting is.
When we can get a quorum.
We've had some difficulty.
Let me check though.
I don't know when CPDC is, like I said, I was supposed to be May 4th, but they bumped me, I think it was like 2 weeks later.
It is May 13th, our next meeting.
Yep.
The 27th.
Allison, will you be?
No,
you're back the 27th, is my record.
I.
But we'll continue it to May 13th.
One thing I would like to see if we can before the next meeting, I'm comfortable with these plans, but the maintenance plan for the rain garden and for the policing the trash, because that should go in the order of conditions. If the applicant wants to draft that and then we can attach it to order of conditions, that's fine, or if not, Chuck can just write one and include it in the order of conditions.
If Chuck's comfortable emailing me, like I presented what I had, if he has some things to add to it or modify and emails it to me, I'll look at it, I can get in court.
Is it really?
Might have some comments.
Yeah, he might want something too.
There's a really good one for e-cars, which you could modify to.
But they don't have a rain garden.
No, but you could, you know, but you could just modify, but it has like a lot of dates in it, which is good.
Yep, it helps.
Do you know if the one at Dr. Raven's, anything had to be done after this winter?
No, I think they just finished it.
Yeah, they.
It wasn't complete in the fall.
Okay, all right.
And then with the winter, I think they just finished it.
Yeah, the one thing I was curious about that is the roof runoff into the rain garden, if that kind of held up. So I was worried about erosion.
Right, erosion, right.
It was funny, if you went by there when the snow finally melted, you could see that the workmen had just walked away and left some of their tools there when the snow melted on some of their tools from there.
Yeah, but take a look at it if you buy it there. It looks good.
Might need to go by there tomorrow.
Okay, any further discussion?
Sure.
Okay, there's a motion to continue to May 13th. Is there a second? Second? All those in favor? Okay.
Thank you very much.
All right, thank you.
No, sign this though. This is out of this sign.
Okay, Whittier.
You don't have a pen, you only have like that.
Oh, and thank you for the half plan. I appreciate that.
Sorry?
I got a couple.
No,
what color do you want?
Yeah.
You've got one.
All right.
There it is.
Yeah, I'm hiding it from you on purpose.
Did we?
No.
I don't think so. Old.
Go, right.
Okay. Anybody need a moment? For him, I have let me just tell you, I've got a.
Brian Tucker.
You want a phone number? It would be his work number. All right. Okay, we're gonna. Okay, we are.
Anytime is fine.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Okay, we're gonna reopen the public hearing. There's a continued or notice of intent. We're gonna reopen the public hearing for continued notice of intent 270-0640, 30 Whittier Road, map 33, lot 148, Johnson. And we're going to open it, reopen it, and conduct it concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 5.7. The applicant will present the proposal. The commission will receive reports from its administrator. The commission will address questions in our comments to the applicant. The public will be given an opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair. Please sign in at the attendance sheet if you haven't yet. And let's introduce ourselves, starting with Julie.
Rebecca Longley.
Jamie Moore.
Anika Scanlon, chair.
Brian Sullivan, vice chair.
Allison Stager.
Chuck Tarani, conservation administrator.
Okay, Mr. Johnson, welcome back.
How you doing?
Good. Took us a couple of times to meet, but we're back. So we have the order of conditions drafted here. Have you received a? Do you have a copy of it?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Are you familiar with these types of documents? Have you seen?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Is this your first time looking at the copy?
It's my first time looking.
Okay. All right. So, a lot of the front matter is pretty standard, pretty boilerplate. So I'll just move on to list of special conditions starts on page. That's pretty standard. I'll open it up to the Conservation Commission. Does anybody have any comments on the order of conditions? Mr. Mullen, you need a moment.
No, I'm good.
Okay.
I mean,
you're hanging in.
I'm coughing, but.
Chuck, was there a condition placed in here about existing healthy trees not?
I saw that condition and added it.
Just
think it covers what we've
okay.
done in the past, and it's on A2.
Okay.
And it starts a couple lines down, have a right to maintain their property in its existing condition.
Okay.
We've done that before.
Yep, we have.
We didn't come up with something that says you cannot take down any trees, but this is what we did on a few. So if it needs to be worked on, then we should do it here. But I will also bring up, there's another complication. I do have the granite bounds in here.
Okay.
But with the deck cantilevered out over the 25-foot line, we need to work on where those bounds are going.
Okay.
I did identify in front of wetland flag 2, 4, and 6, which would be both ends of the property and in the center. But are they going on the 10-foot line? Are they going on the 25-foot line?
Gotcha. Okay. Let me just pull that out.
And that would be A1, you know, really we're working on A1, 2, and A1 and A2.
In our
package?
Do you have any
extra
more copies?
Yeah, you want to, I could take
yours. I'm going to assign this one. So if you
where is the language? Where is the language?
Second to last page. Second to last page. A2.
The nail. Sorry, I had the old plan.
bands?
Yeah, those.
That's on A1.
What, are we gonna come back to A2?
We could start either place, just, we'll just start. So the concrete bounds, we say, are at the wetland line or at the?
Usually on the 25-foot.
25-foot zone is natural.
The 25-foot, and here, that's exactly the issue with, okay. If it goes under the deck. Let's see, this is 1 to 40, what are the bound spacing?
It doesn't say.
Okay, so that's.
Seems like a really good spot if you wanted to modify it, would be at the, just a break in the slope.
Yep.
Is A2 the only place we talk about the concrete bands?
It's mentioned in A1.
Oh, 2 feet in ground at turning point. Is there a turning point under the cantilever deck?
No.
No.
No, but it, but also goes, only 25-foot line at, in front of flag, you know, 2, 4, and 6. So you, it's really.
So if there's no concrete bound turning point under the deck, then that, the line, if you connect two bands, goes under the deck, which is okay.
Yeah, let me pull the fan, I thought there was a, it's not straight across, it goes in back of the garage.
It is, no, take.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There is a one turning point somewhere.
According to this, it looks like it goes straight, here, I'll highlight it so you can see it from where you are. But the 25-foot goes, the 25-foot looks to go like that.
So we're only talking.
Looks straight to me.
Yeah, it looks pretty straight. So you want to just say in one on either end?
Sure.
That'd be fine.
And it could be, and those bounds could be flush?
There should be one at the property line, and there's only one turning point, so there are only 3 of them.
Right.
But it should be at the property line, each property line, and the one turning point, that's good.
So.
So you're okay with the 25-foot line at the one turning point and the property lines?
Yep, yep.
So there are only 3.
Are you okay with that, Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Okay.
And we can just modify the language to say that, Charlie.
3.
Instead of just saying.
So I'll make my own legend here.
At the turning point, along the 25.
At the turning point and property boundaries along 25 feet north of growing vegetated wetland flag.
Okay. One other issue is, that I'd like to sort of discuss, and please steer me to where it is in the order, is, so some trees are being removed as part of construction. For example, the 20-inch tree in the driveway, and there's a couple, there's a 2 10-inch and a 6-inch. I don't know if.
No, I didn't write that in the plan.
Here, I'll just pass you the original plan if you need to see it.
I don't, but it's, I didn't write down the trees that are being removed in the order, because it refers to the plan.
Yep, gotcha.
But I did mention the tree well and that tree.
Yes.
And I took a guess on it.
Yeah, that's a 12-inch tree.
I don't know if it is.
Sure. Mr. Johnson, do you remember, do you remember your plan?
Yeah.
Just kind of refresh my memory as to how many trees are gonna be taken out. I had 4 listed, but is that correct? So it'll be the 6-inch, the 10-inch, the 10-inch, and the 20-inch on or near the proposed driveway?
Actually, we're
saving, putting a well around the 12-inch.
Right.
I thought it was the 20 that was in the driveway, the 210s, the 68, and then there was a 5-inch that was near the garage.
So the 8 and the 5-inch, you're proposing?
Yes, I thought those 6 were coming out.
Okay, so the 5-inch, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
It was only to that left-hand side by the garage.
All those, okay. Especially within the 100 feet within the wetland, one thing we have done in the past is requested that some sort of other plantings be put in to replace those trees.
Within the 100 feet?
Yep.
Where's the 100-foot line?
There's the 100-foot line. So,
Well, that's within the 50, maybe within the 35.
Well, yeah, here's the 35. The yellow is the 25.
Right,
so,
right.
So do you have any plans or anything we can put in the order to sort of, to say stipulate as a planting?
Well, the plantings that LEC had done that were going to affect one of the holes.
Sorry, yeah, please. Did they do? I'm sorry, it's been so long since we've met.
Yeah.
That's okay.
Give me.
We're doing all these plantings in here.
Oh, okay.
That was specified by Rich Kirby at LEC.
Okay.
Yeah, he really has a significant planting plan. Plus the removing the leaf pile at the back of the garage.
Right.
That's more than sufficient.
Yep, okay.
There's a lot going on this project.
Yeah.
Yep, there is. Here it is. I'm sorry. There it is.
So, I wasn't paying close enough attention. Why does that 5-inch, 8-inch, and 10-inch tree have to come out?
Well, a couple are in the driveway.
The 210s and the 20
the
are in the driveway.
And six.
Okay.
And the other ones are near where the garage is coming down.
And this is the proposed planting plan to go back there. Okay. All right. I think that planting plan is sufficient to replace those trees. Okay.
I
just wanted to revisit that.
The question I had, Chuck, if I understood you correctly, you said that this phrase in A2 on page 18, have a right to maintain the property in its existing condition. You're saying that takes care of the prohibition of cutting down healthy trees in the future?
Well, that's what we've used before.
No, we had phrases in there about no healthy trees between the structure and the wetlands can be taken down. That's the language.
I think we stuck it in.
What?
We just put in that phrase.
Yeah, that's what we want. And we want that standard in all order of conditions, is that it can be no future cutting of healthy trees. Between the approved structures and the wetland boundaries.
Do you know if...
I'm just trying to think of which one that started on. Was it Azalea Circle? I mean, this was...
I can't remember which one.
But it's out there. I'll just pop it in. That's not a big deal.
Okay.
Okay. Good. And if we can get it in the template, that'll save us time and money, energy in the future.
Yep. Okay, so besides that, are there any more comments or questions about the order of conditions? Would you like a little bit more time to review?
Actually, it's right, it's still on page 18. A subletter A to condition 19.
Here.
Is that the what you would consider the as-built?
Yes.
Okay. So is the statement the as-built, or just like a couple letters saying, but, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, some sort of, that's a pretty standard part of the order that asks for a qualified professional to testify that the order of condition was followed.
Yep.
And that the details specified in the order, that the order was complied with.
Yeah.
So you're asking about the.
And I'm just making sure that, is that in the form of the as-built plan?
No.
It accompanies the as-built.
No, it's a written statement.
It accompanies.
It accompanies the as-built.
So.
So a written statement.
If there's no variation from this order of conditions, the as-built plan would be submitted, stamped with a statement that this conforms with the conditions, the order of conditions.
Understood.
Or it varies in these aspects.
I understand. Thank you.
It's a both and though. It's a written statement and an as-built plan.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay.
That saves us the work of having to check, or it's a double check on the as-built.
So, I don't have any other questions about the order of conditions. So Mr. Johnson, when you're, if you don't have any other questions, we'll just proceed.
I don't, I'm good, thank you.
Okay. I move we.
I think we already accepted it. I think all we have to do is sign it.
Oh, did we already approve this?
I read the minutes and it said you just continued it.
Did we what?
We just
continued it. So.
Then why don't we just do a motion?
The minutes said that you just continued it at the last meeting. Where did those minutes go?
Do you have any questions? Okay.
I
know she's here from for Timberneck. Maybe you're also here for this as well. I don't know. So I don't want to jump to conclusions. So thanks.
Motion was made by.
Thanks. Yeah.
Jamie.
To do what?
To continue this hearing until April 8th. We didn't have that meeting.
Okay. So I move we close the hearing.
So it's just continued.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay, I move we approve the order of conditions as amended tonight.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay.
Jamie?
Thank you.
Opposed?
Sorry.
Abstained?
No, I voted.
You approved?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, thank you, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you all. Good evening.
And do you know the timeline for getting the final document for? I think there's a 10-day appeal, if you don't mind. Right, Chuck? There's a 10-day
appeal.
Yes,
there's a 10-day appeal.
Yeah.
Then you're good to go after that.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, thanks.
You can't waive that appeal period within notice of intent.
Do I have to bring the order to the clerk that would stamp or something like that?
No, you don't have to do that, but you do have to bring it to the register of deed and have it recorded and then bring back proof of recording.
After the 10.
No, you can do that anytime.
Okay.
Here you go.
Yeah.
Clear as mud?
Very good.
Clear as mud, or?
But this copy right here, the one I have, serve as the one to record.
No,
they're
going to sign a copy.
Modification or two.
And then I have to sign that myself, send it to DP, send it to you. You can pick it up tomorrow. Anytime if you want it.
That was my next question.
So anytime after 2 o'clock. Okay.
I'll see you tomorrow.
Great.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks a lot.
All right. Okay, recycle this one. Okay, no more hearings, but let's discuss Timberneck Swamp signage. Did you want to, just for the sake of the record, would you like to just introduce yourself? And
I'm Dorothy Marshall, Timberneck Drive.
Yeah, is there anything you wanted to just sort of start out with, any questions or comments?
I'd like to see how the signs will read and maybe
happy to answer your question, any questions you might have. I went out with Chuck and with the Kinnick Swamp a couple of weeks ago.
Okay.
And came up on some things, and of course I'd be interested in any of your suggestions for how to, solve our problem.
Chuck, why don't you just go into what you saw out there?
So I hope everyone got my email.
Pictures, yeah.
So we have, everyone can just look at this and pass that down. So I went out into Timonex Swamp and identified two tree stands and a game camera in the area. And I had a GPS with me, and we were able to mark the locations on this plan, working with the town and with Kim Honischlag. So
can you leave that open, Dave?
Thank you. I feel like that plan kind of showed a lot of what's out there. And the other thing that we discovered is half of that up and dry mound is conservation land, and the other half seems to be that private land.
So were the tree stands on private land? Or
one was on conservation land and one was on the private land. And, there's a plus and minus here with the GPS, maybe a couple meters. But it seems like one is on conservation land.
Okay.
So they have been there for a long time. They seem to, the straps seem to be pretty taut around the trees. One was chained, but all in all it was...
Do you remember what species of tree they were on?
Some sort of hardwood, maybe...
they were hardwood?
Yeah, it wasn't a pine tree.
Yeah, definitely.
As a matter of fact, there's a picture right there.
Definitely hardwood.
Yeah.
So
were they in wetlands or up?
No, it was in that. It was on that dry area, kind of in a clearing.
I assume so, because I think there's only one dry raised area.
Is that a lock?
That's a damn good lock. that's one heck of a lock.
We'll stop a cutoff wheel.
But I,
the lock.
It's hard to know what you actually can do and where the property line is, at least where that is, that camera. And one of those tree stands seems to be definitely on private property.
Yeah. I think, so at this point,
So we did want, so the other thing that I did when I was out there is I brought my metal detector. I have a pretty good metal detector.
Mm-hmm.
And I used that until the batteries ran out. And we didn't come across any shells, any shotgun shells, any arrows, anything like that. I found a bunch of cans. I found some plumbing stuff. I found a sign.
Any money?
Couple of rings.
Right.
It's not the easiest place to get into.
No, it's not.
So it would have been nice to have a shovel with me, but can't spend all day out there having fun. So didn't find any money. There was, the thing does say coin, it says ring, it says things like that. And those were coming up every once in a while. So
the metal detector tells you what it's detecting?
Yeah.
Boy, they've advanced since I used
them. Yeah, I used to use them down at Salisbury Beach,
Right. Right.
So there's a few of that.
What was the hole? You found a hole?
A hole.
No, that hole is just some, I have no idea what it was.
How big was that?
It's like a crater.
Yeah, it's like a crater, like a bomb went off.
Probably about double the size of that area there.
Was it an old tree?
Oh, no, it's at least 7 feet deep. It's like
really?
Just think of a pyramid flipped over, and then it's just a big hole.
Was there vegetation growing on the bottom?
No.
So it's
fresh. I actually
earth?
Walked in it. Yeah, there's actually some trash and whatnot down there. So I would have thought it was some sort of excavation, but how did anyone get out there?
Yeah, it's not hand dug being that big.
Bizarre.
It is, they spent all
the time.
Very motivated.
There's a bunch of shallow excavation areas, too, the size of don't wanna say, well, you know, the size of like a large man, I guess, something like that. It's kinda odd.
You might wanna stay out of there from here forward.
Yeah, right.
Oh, did you see the one with the chairs?
I saw the chairs.
Yeah,
they don't look very old.
And did anyone listen to the news back on the 20th?
No.
It says 4/20.
Yeah.
That's National Park Day.
Yeah, so it also means something else.
Oh, what does it mean? I don't know the other one.
Well, it's legal in Colorado.
Okay.
That's another word for
And Timbernack Swamp?
And Timbernack Swamp, apparently.
Bring a chair.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, no, that's
so we did I,
so,
and
so
I did
with
get
the metal
on
detecting though, you said you didn't find any actual like munitions debris.
Yeah, I mean, I was doing a lot of things at once and I wasn't
no
concentrating
shells,
on one
no
thing.
Mm-hmm.
But up in that up and dry area, I did really try to only search for metal and did take my time to dig up a few things. I didn't find anything. So, I mean, it could be searched again, but to me, there was nothing out there. We found, what are those things called? Juice boxes,
mm-hmm,
or juice bags, if anyone,
yeah,
you know, like, you know,
yeah,
when those came out. So, you know, figure out when that happened. So there was a bunch of those out there. There was chairs in one area. I mean, the place is used. And then
sounds like kids to me.
Did you go out with Bren?
Mm-hmm.
And Bren and Dorothy found a dolly and a ladder.
A dolly is in a child
like a
doll,
hand truck
or a hand truck.
Hand truck.
No, no.
Ladder and a log with a big rope on it, and that was very close to Charles Street. It was easily accessible. We started out near Bryn's house to find that other tree stand, and we couldn't find it. And so then we went back towards Charles Street, and we came upon the dolly, the cart, and the as you mentioned, the other items. The ladder, about 5 to 6 feet tall, one of those ladders that. And then a large log that had been cut with a yellow, like a marine rope on it.
Mm-hmm.
And then we went to the Table Street sign to try to get in there, but it was so wet, we just, you can't really go
right
through there. But
right,
I had heard that there were stands in there too,
mm-hmm,
but the mud soaked into my boots, and I said, oh, right now.
Need muck boots.
But when we found the tree stands he's referring to, those are the ones I found in the wintertime when I said, okay, I'm tired of listening to this gunshot. I'm going to walk out straight from my house and continue on. And I expected to find traps or something. And I came upon those two tree stands.
Do you remember at that point when you walked out in the wintertime, did you see tracks in the snow?
I wasn't looking. The snow was really deep, and it was a workout, to be honest with you. But I was when I got there, I thought, wow, I'm really much closer to another neighborhood than to my house. And that's why I thought it was Belmont Street. But now, having been there and having walked back to my car, I'm sure it was Ivy Lane that I was looking at all the time. So I think it's much more easily accessible from Ivy Lane than from Belmont Street to get to this area where the two tree stands are. And that's where I hear the shot, and I say that to the police. No, I've said that for years. I hear it. It's straight across. I said, don't drive by my house. Go down Libby Ave.
Yeah. Yeah. Becca, do you have something to add?
We were. Weren't we out here?
We were
we
out
just
there.
Didn't see those stands.
No, we didn't.
Oh.
It's, yeah, it's hard to, you really have to get used to what you're looking at.
Yeah,
we were generally
one,
looking
you
down,
can,
though.
It's easy
yeah
to find
to
look a
second
one.
Sure, we
were
going to break our
yeah
feet,
yeah,
knees,
yeah,
walking through it.
It was easier in the snow, the contrast.
We were there in the snow, and it was not bad walking. We did see some tracks, and we tried to follow them, and then we lost them.
Yeah, we lost them.
Well, I did see, when I was there in the wintertime, I thought they were like earlier tracks, because I noticed that they were indents with newly fallen leaves in them, and they were going towards that street, that neighborhood that I'm telling
yeah
you about.
Yeah.
That's the way they were leading, but I didn't follow them too bad. It was a workout.
But when we were in right here, you could definitely see the backyards along Timberneck Drive.
Mm.
So just to summarize, though, the status of these properties, according to John Halsey, right, the property owner has agreed to no hunting on that property, and there's clearly no hunting in Timberneck. So when we come across stuff, miscellaneous stuff that people have put there or set up there, you know, Chuck had suggested tagging it and saying no, no hunting, please remove, or, I mean, I think some sort of warning.
If it's private property, it's the responsibility of the owner.
Right, but on our property.
Right.
On our property.
Even if he says no, no hunting, we have absolutely no jurisdiction.
I think those.
I agree.
The two
I'm talking about our property.
That are on that up and dry area, I think we can get those removed by the owner.
Yeah.
What, one of them looks like it's in Timberneck Swamp.
Mm.
It's off that dry private property piece, like this one right here.
Right.
But the wildlife camera also looks like it's on the private property, right?
It does.
You're saying we can get them removed by the owner of the equipment or the owner of the property?
Yeah, I think we can.
We could at least ask
figure
the
out
owner.
Who it is, or we know who it is, and you know, that's
well,
something
I,
that
I,
the
I
town's
don't
working on.
I don't
on.
Understand what
oh,
you're
okay.
saying.
I see.
I'm saying that I think that someone's going to talk to the owner, and
the
he's going to be told to
property?
take the stuff
yeah.
out of
mm-hmm.
it. No, the guy that owns the
private property.
The tree stands.
Do we know who that is?
Sounds like sounds
yeah, but
like
we don't
do.
Know. We don't know on TV.
We
don't
it sounds
know.
Like we do. Yeah.
We don't know
somebody
why.
In this
yeah.
room knows, but
well,
no names will be mentioned
we,
at this point in time.
How
it
do
doesn't
we know
matter.
Who
to me.
Owns the tree stand?
I think because we've been dealing with this for years, and that's
it's history.
It's kind
of
names kept
is.
Coming up
yeah.
multiple times.
Yeah.
And so.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I'm in the dark.
I'll be glad.
How do we know who owns them?
Well, we don't know exactly if the guy owns them or not, if that's what you're asking, but
pretty,
we have a good assumption.
Pretty
and,
good assumption.
And we're going to pursue that.
And what are we going to do?
Tell them to move, tell them to take the stuff out of there.
I think getting this stuff out of there is a great, you know.
I mean, that may or may not happen. I think that if
forward.
Whoever tells them to remove the stuff and he ends up not doing it, I don't know what'll happen if it's
but that's
discovered
not our jurisdiction
that, yeah, it's not
anyway.
Our it's not
yeah.
our issue.
We can't tell a private.
Mm.
Well, I think for anything on the private land, we don't do anything about that.
No.
If somebody wants to notify the owner that somebody's used their land, that's fine. But I don't think that's.
Oh no, we have nothing to do with the Conservation Commission or myself have nothing to do with requesting that those tree stands are removed.
Yeah.
Except for the
did
one
you
on our property.
The rules of use for conservation land?
No, I did not. But I can grab them if you want. Maybe we can take a break and
because
I can grab
I
those
don't
two
think
things.
We have any prohibition against photographing wildlife in conservation land.
yeah, we don't, but
generally, wildlife photograph cameras are not unattended.
Oh, good, thank you.
I organize
should
my
we,
papers.
Do you want, are you
so
suggesting
I have
we modify it?
So I
no,
have a copy
I think
of
we should encourage wildlife photography. Absolutely.
But I don't see taking down those stands as a way to prohibit wildlife photography. I think those stands are generally
to the stands. If somebody wants to put a observation stand temporary in conservation land, they should come before us and
absolutely.
Ask us, and we could approve it or not for a.
There's
for
actually
a
language. About where to put stands that you guys have, or some conservation commission in Reading has put together, requesting that they go on certain trees.
Yeah.
So, I totally agree. But out here, this is not observation. We have a person that chases people off. We have a person that considers it's his own land. We have tree stands. We have people seeing this. We have hearsay, and a game camera. This is a hunting area. Those are hunting stands. That's a wildlife camera.
Yeah. I think.
I'm sorry. I don't, unless we know.
Well, that's fine. We're not in saying we're going to take them down, but.
Well, I have to say
it
this
is
particular,
what it is.
This particular stand, nobody came before us to get permission to put that stand up on Timberneck Swamp. Not in my lifetime being on the commission.
Hmm.
I would have remembered that. So even if it is permitted there, no one got specific permission for that tree stand. So
As I read it, I don't see anything that requires permission. Maybe
for a
we
structure
should add that.
To be put up in conservation
I think we
land,
should add
I think.
That.
Why don't we take that up, but what's your sense about this particular issue right now?
This is what I would do, comes up to me. I would take the stand that we think's on conservation land, and we only know one, correct, that's on conservation land?
Seems like it.
Yeah.
And we place a sign on it saying this is on conservation land. Please come before the Conservation Commission. And in order to discuss this, if not done so by X date, it will be removed. That's what I would do.
I agree. That's fine.
And we, if the camera though, we think is on private.
I don't think.
Right?
Yeah, the camera. That is part of the whole puzzle. So that's the only reason why I keep on saying game camera.
And I think we should amend those. Rules and regulations to say that if anybody wants to put a wildlife observation facility or install camera, that they come before the Conservation Commission and request permission.
They can even put a tree stand up because we actually have a couple of hunting areas in Redding that the commission approves of. Bear Meadow and
right.
And what's that other place?
North
and South, yeah.
Cedar
Swamp, yeah.
Right.
So,
and if somebody wants to put an observation platform somewhere else on a temporary basis.
I
think it'd be great.
Again,
they need to come before us.
The only thing about this whole situation that kind of rubbed me the wrong way was someone took ownership of this place and chased people out of what was conservation land.
What do you mean they chased them out?
This is some of the stories we hear.
Many trust.
Kids can't go in there in certain times, or someone says, get out of here, this is private property, and they're just walking around. You know, this is what we're hearing.
Yeah.
You know, it's just
yeah.
Another story.
I don't believe everything I hear.
Well, when there's
well, I hear it like many times.
Well, when there's multiple reports.
It seems to me
I got it with first hand, sure. Two people. So.
Okay. So I liked your idea of tagging the
anything that requires me not to lug that thing out of the woods. I like.
Okay. I see two things going forward. You know, putting something on that tree, whatever's in our land, to give warning that it needs to be removed and they need to come before us.
With the date.
With the date. I don't know how that's going
to... Or they need to come before us or it'll be removed within next day.
But it's, you know, we're kind of sending it out like a message in a bottle. You know, it's kind of just placed out there. Putting some flagging on it or something like call conservation or this may be removed. Or this
will
is going,
be removed.
Will be removed. And then the next step is talking to the private property owner or whoever.
That's the selectmen that are doing
and
that.
So you contact the selectmen. And tell them, let them know about this other stuff. And
we're going to be there Tuesday night.
Right.
Are they
aware of what you found recently?
So,
what's going to happen Tuesday night?
I'm going to just update it. This wasn't put together for our benefit. This was put together so we can go to the conservation to the selectmen's meeting and show them what's out there and request that. They offered to pay for signs. We just want to make sure that that's still
yeah.
their intention. And to show them where we're going to put the signs and to say that we have no hunting signs by order of the Redding Conservation Commission, and we're going to have no hunting signs that don't say per order of the Conservation Commission on that private property.
So the selectmen are going to pay for no hunting signs on the private property?
Yes.
You know, the only
well,
way...
Well, this is what we were told. We're going to make sure that that's where they're at now.
Here's the thing. Where does the private property end and the conservation property begin?
Yeah.
The only way you know is by locating those lot lines.
No, you don't, it's no hunting throughout, we have, there's supposedly a letter, if I put a sign that doesn't say no hunting on it, anywhere close, you know, it's fine.
We've got the property owners.
It's, I don't have to be exact to say no hunting in this area, it just doesn't say per order of the Conservation Commission, we have a letter that says he's revoked all the hunting on that private property.
Could say per order of property owner, and wherever it is, it's correct.
Yeah, you could say that, maybe that's a good idea.
Per order of property owner, and then if it's on the private property, it's fine, if it's on the conservation property, it's.
Yeah.
Conservation property, so one sign fits all for the whole area.
Is this tree stand, this, there was a tree stand here?
Okay, so that tree stand that was removed, I never saw, and this one over here that was removed, I never saw. But, that was Bryn, who took a picture with her camera, and she got the GPS coordinates off that, from what I understand. She just provided me with the coordinates.
Is this wooded right here?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
So it's pretty much all wooded in back of all these guys' houses.
Okay.
And pretty thick. The owner of that property grabbed that tree stand. He said it was on his property.
And he took it down?
He took it.
That's a.
That one.
So it's gone.
It's gone, there's two gone, there's two left that we know of.
One on private property, one on conservation land.
Right.
Okay.
So we've had two removed, one before, this was before we got heavily involved, and one after I started making some noise.
Just a question, allegedly, is it the same person?
No.
No.
The person that owned the one that's removed understands the situation and won't be back.
Who is the owner of the property?
I'm not part of the owner who owns this property, we can look it up on the, on this, but I think it's a trust. Yeah, so we can look it up on the, online thing, but like I said, I think it's a trust.
So.
But you said.
Do you know how they found the property owner? I know that Bryn had a, had something.
For the parcel.
Private parcel.
Yeah. Yeah.
Someone on Belmont Street looked him up and called him in Florida.
Somebody gets the tax bill, it's easy to find a property owner.
Yeah.
He has an address in Wakefield, but I think he lives in Florida a lot.
Okay, so at this point, there's a meeting next week, I will be there,
There you go, this is, can you see that, Jamie?
Nope.
No, it's off.
No.
It's off.
It's
off.
Haha.
Turn around. And signs, I assume, I'm hoping they approve it, and, I don't see why they wouldn't.
They can't deny that it's not happening now, I mean.
Yeah, yeah. It's got John Halsey's involvement in it, and it's got his support, you know, and so.
And we're just. We're just showing them where.
Where things are gonna happen and.
Where we're gonna put stuff. Couple of these streets are, which I talked to Bryn about, are private streets, so we would need the owners, so this is not all the locations, we're probably gonna have to modify this map. So, I don't know, F Street, one side of F Street, and D Street is private or something like that. So we need permission to put the tree, the no hunting signs at the end of the street, and we could obviously put them in on our property, but they'd be deep in the woods.
Okay.
Total assessment, $13,000.
$500 a year.
$500's gone up, it was $190.
Man.
Oh, is it?
Allison, did you have a question?
No, just about the wording of the sign, did we change that, or are we leaving it with the Conservation Commission and then just the no hunting or by property owner?
I think no hunting by property owner is, I mean, we could bring that, I think that's, I think that's more appropriate for that whole area.
And I think they would be happier with that, so that they would.
Yeah.
I think they would be happier with that, so that way they made a certain number of signs that could be used anywhere, rather than like making 13 signs and we needed 15, or something like that, I think that'll.
So by property owner?
However you wanna word it, but I think property owner sort of thing.
Go ahead and ask.
I have a question, this complicates things, but I think about it all the time. You know, and I spoke to Chuck about it, I said, you know, some people, like the environmental police, have suggested it's someone who's trapping and executing the animal. So by law, do you have to have a sign that says no trapping? Because, I mean, on the one hand.
That's not hunting?
Excuse me?
Because that's not hunting?
No, it's not hunting.
But, you know, on the one hand, there's no discharge of firearms in Reading, but someone's obviously firing a gun all the time. But if you say there's no hunting and someone is actually shooting an animal that he's trapped and not hunted, is there no violation, although we all know he's violating by shooting anyway? I don't know.
Do the signs have to say no
trapping, no hunting
and
trapping? We refer that to Town Council?
I always see no hunting.
Because by law, you cannot transport a live animal, so if you catch an animal in a trap, you have to execute it.
Right, but you need a permit to trap.
Mm-hmm.
I know all about trapping. If you want any questions, ask me. I did it for many years.
Do you need a license to trap?
You need a license to... You need a license to trap, which you can get at like any sporting goods store. But you need to obtain two permits from the state.
Okay.
One to properly operate certain traps, and another one you need to get a trapping number that you need to put on your trap. And then once a year, you have to get the thing. So for me to think that someone's out there shooting an animal with a have-a-hot trap, no one's shooting through a cage. That's ridiculous, and you'd really have to be insane to think that that's happening. So, a have-a-hot trap? So
yes,
we're hearing someone is shooting the animal once it's caught. You're not going to take the animal out and shoot it. You'd have to shoot it through the cage, and no one's going to do that, in my opinion.
Yeah. It's not a have-a-hot trap. It's a clean trap.
There's only one way you can get a quick kill trap or a conibear trap, and that is with a permit from the health department for an emergency permit to
take. You can get it on eBay. I'm dead serious.
You can buy the trap, but you don't have a permit to do it.
Right, but we don't think that this person is.
Oh yeah,
the,
well
yeah,
sure.
License.
Yeah.
Well, you can just go up the street and get it in Maine.
I have a question for you. I mean, if somebody's doing that, has anybody actually seen those traps in there?
Nobody looks, to be honest with you. That's why I went out in the wintertime, because when I call the police, they'll drive slowly down the street, and I say, please don't drive slowly down the street. It's from the spawn. And, I have an officer on my deck looking out, and I'm pointing to where the shots are coming from. But no one ever goes in the swamp to investigate. It's always at nighttime. It's always in the dark. And it happens between November and March when the clocks change backwards and forwards. Although a neighbor called me a week ago and said, did you hear the shot? And I hadn't. She claimed she heard a shot the other night, and I hadn't. But it generally, I've lived there 13, 14 years, it usually stops mid-March. So
there's a lot of trapping that doesn't happen under the ice. So we went through this when we were walking around, and I'm just not believing that.
Back to this question about the not to have part. If you have a...
Conibear.
A trapping license. And you have the number, and you have the whole thing. What kind of trap do you use?
Well, you can only...
You don't use a have-a-hard trap, do you?
No, you don't. But there's there's a suitcase trap that you can use.
Right.
So during the season, you can trap,
right.
But you need a special permit to trap with the quick-kill traps. So an emergency permit.
But if you want to trap... for fur or trap for sport, what type of trap do you use?
I guess you would be stuck with either using the suitcase or the conibear trap.
Right.
And the conibear is quick kill, so there's
right.
no shooting there.
Right. And same with the suitcase.
No, the suitcase captures them inside. It's
okay.
It casts them inside, and usually what you do is drown them.
So we don't prohibit trapping.
No, but to trap on private land, you would need the permission of the landowner. You have to obtain that permission.
But this isn't private land.
They'd have to get conservation permission. We had to get greenbelt permission when we were trapping on that land. So big parcels count, you know.
Does anyone in town know you need permission, though?
No, anyone can do anything they want if they're not caught, but...
isn't that the
truth?
Well, we should address trapping in these regulations. We don't.
There's no huts, dens, beaver dams out there on that I didn't see one on that, the drainage area. That's where you're gonna track.
No, I mean, on all the conservation land. Because I know there'd be right there on the conservation land at the right four feet.
Well, you know, it goes without saying that you would need permission. I mean, it is illegal unless you get permission.
It doesn't go without saying.
Well, you're just doubling up on something that's needed. You're saying, look, we should say it here, and it also says it somewhere else. You need permission to trap on someone else's property. You don't have that right.
That's the law.
That's it.
Well, we address hunting.
I'm not saying we can't do it. I'm just saying that you are doubling up on something.
If we follow your logic, we can take the hunting language out of here.
What does it say about hunting?
Says you can hunt.
You can't hunt within 500 feet of another house.
Right, but it says you can hunt on that land.
What land is that?
No, it specifies what land.
Some land you can, some land you can't. So we should just say.
You're right. You don't need the hunting. You don't need the hunting information in this either. It's you shouldn't be able to hunt. There's some areas where you could in the very center. But you have to be shooting.
No,
around
I'm talking about general. This applies to all conservation land in Redding. I'm not talking specifically about Timberneck Swamp right now. I'm saying we should address wildlife observation, wildlife photography, and trapping in our regulations.
Well, we'll address that in an upcoming meeting. We'll get it on the agenda or something.
Now, do we have to hold a public meeting, public hearing to change these
regulations? Yeah.
I know in general we have to change the regulations.
Right.
I assume that's true for these regulations too.
You bring up some really good points, but I think we should get it on to a future meeting. So you said trapping.
Trapping, wildlife observation, wildlife photography. Wildlife observation from a fixed location.
We should also put on there areas that no hunting is allowed, just so we're...
It's on there.
Just so it's clear.
It's in there.
Oh, by the way, item 12 on our regulations is dumping, littering, filling, or any other deposition of imported materials, included but not limited to garbage, debris, earth, leaves, or brush, is prohibited on conservation land.
Mm.
Right.
So,
well, there you go.
So there it is. It is written down there. So.
The third, did you get the third one?
Observation and photography. So that's the update on this particular parcel. In terms of trapping and versus hunting, I'm not sure. I mean, how big are these traps? Are these things that are like the size of suitcases that would clearly be dragged in and dragged out?
No, these are huge traps.
Okay, so traps. If somebody's trapping, it's very obvious.
Well, you could have that hi-hi trap, but, you know, again, you got to convince that animal to hop on inside, and that doesn't usually work.
I would think that someone who's violating the law with a gun would be using a link hole trap or something, because he has no regard for law anyway.
Well,
you know, why would he use a hi-hi trap?
So
I don't know. I mean, you could use a leg hole trap if you were going after coyote. And you do have to dispatch them because they're going to be alive. But
I mean,
it's usually you're not catching coyote in the middle of like this forest. It has to be an open area. And you need to set it up. I mean, it would be up on that up and dry area, but we would have seen like a clearing, because when they're caught, they actually get rid of all the leaf litter because they're dragging that chain around.
Right. Right, so it almost seems unlikely that if there is an official trapper.
The police suggested that to me, so it sounds like someone's shooting a trap in. That's what he said.
Well, he's saying that from the outside. He's looking in.
So
when we were out there,
yeah.
I have to tell you, I didn't see. Now it can happen. I'm not saying that I specifically looked or anything.
Okay.
But if you're going to set a trap, you want to see signs. I didn't see sign of any animal. There's a lot of deer out there, I know that, but you don't trap deer.
That's what I was looking for a trap that day. I went out in the snow looking upon the two tree stands. I was kind of surprised, because that's, again, and I don't mean to hold you up. I appreciate your...
Yeah,
well, thanks for coming again.
No.
We'll see you Tuesday. And
you.
And why don't we move on with another agenda item?
This is so much fun.
It is fun, isn't it?
It's good.
Okay, so,
So what would you, how would I have a heart trap anyways?
Mice.
You get
field mice, so you can feed your other animals.
I don't know. Field mice last night.
No, you can do it. So, like, raccoon, you can do, like, a raccoon, and you can do squirrel. They can do that, like, at your house.
Huge raccoons around.
I mean,
but
the difference between your house and out in the woods is you're trapping an animal because it got into your attic, so you put it right there where he's coming
right,
in.
Right.
Or at your trash barrel. When you're out in the woods, he's got the whole woods to walk around in. You gotta find a trail.
The only thing that you might get.
Yeah.
What would you do for a fox? Because I could see fox out there.
The fox are very curious. So what you do is you make some sort of thing that they recognize, and they stick their paw in it.
Can we have a conference about
animals
later? I'd like to move on.
A little bit of.
Chuck, did Mr. Couillard talk to you about
I couldn't
preparing
make it
a plan
yesterday
for
or today out to his site?
Is that what he was waiting on?
He thought he was supposed to come in. I just told him I couldn't make it. My schedule was full.
That's fine. I met him out on site on Sunday morning.
And I sent that email saying that you wanted a plan.
Yes. Okay. Thanks. And no word back? Because he told me an email that he was going to have a plan for me at the site visit. And there was no plan. And then at the site visit, his in-person discussion with me was, well, if I have to prepare a whole nother site plan, I'm just not going to do this. I'm just going to grade it down. I said, well, fine. So I don't know what he wants to do with that, but if he prepares a site plan, then put him on the next agenda. If not, oh, well.
Okay.
So, Trails Committee, Bear Meadow Trail Maintenance Discussion. So for the site visit on Sunday, I met 5 people from Trails Committee to walk around. And Chuck, did Kim give you the map?
We're meeting with Kim. We have an appointment.
Okay.
So.
Okay, so there were a number of locations in Bear Meadow that needed some help, some low areas that were wet, that needed some sort of span or bridge or something to cross. There were a couple areas where there's generally a flat path where they previously put some crushed stone. DPW a previous year put crushed stone, and it's needed a little bit more. Crushed stone is needed in a couple areas. We're only talking about a couple inches of fill on the trail. So Kim asked me, what do we need to do to move this forward? I said, well, you got to find out about your general permit, and then why don't we sit down and talk about it so that you don't just come before us at a meeting and work out the permit then and there. Let's do it ahead of time. So I offered to meet with her and with Chuck, and we have a meeting lined up next Tuesday at 1:15-ish here in Town Hall.
I don't know. Yeah, so it is on Tuesday, so I don't know the time.
Yeah.
Hopefully what they're doing is in the general permit.
Yeah, everything's happening Tuesday. So I told them I would come with the Boy Scout bridge designs that we've already approved, because and they've helped to build them, you know, and so they can just take their pick of which design they want to use for which location, and it's just kind of straightforward and easy. So, okay, so the next item, town-wide cleanup day. You just sort of introduce that?
I printed something out, but essentially a resident of Reading wants to do a townwide cleanup. I talked to Jean Delios, and she sent out an email and said, ask your committees if someone wants to work with this person to champion this cause.
Okay.
So.
Is anybody interested in working with a resident to?
They're asking all the committees. If it's
doesn't,
it's not just our committee. So I think DPW responded. Don't know the result of it.
If no one else is going to step up, you know, put me down, I cannot meet next week. I don't know when they're, do you know when they're slated to try and hold this townwide
cleanup? I think they would just provide you this person's email address.
Okay.
and then you guys just raise it up from the ground.
Okay. Piece of cake.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, I'll write it down. We'll see what happens.
Okay. Something you want to share?
Yeah, I'm looking at the biocide. The biocide they're using for mosquito control. It's bacterium. It's not a pesticide.
Why don't we skip then to East Middlesex mosquito control, and then we'll go up to the. Go ahead, Brian.
So they're using BTI, and don't ask me to pronounce it. It's Bacillus. I'm not going to pronounce it. Anyway, essentially, it's like the stuff I use in my lawn. I use nematodes on my lawn to control grubs. And I won't go into the mechanism, but it essentially eats them from the outside, inside out, but the grubs, that is. So it's similar in that aspect, in that they're going to be applying in the large wetland areas this BTI for mosquito larvae. It's a very targeted approach, and there's very little leftover residual after about 48 hours. And apparently they've used 40 tons of it in West Africa alone with no issues.
In West Africa?
Yeah.
West Africa, yeah. No indications of human health or non-target effects have been reported. I think it's great that they're using that instead of pesticides.
Good.
I suppose if they're going to use something, you know, I'm glad they're using something like that. So it seems to me that's going to be... That's going to be not a terrible thing, right? I suppose it's
okay.
Better than Triple E, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. 364 Lowell Street, 40B.
Is that, that's the same parcel they came up with?
Yes.
To put four houses or three houses there?
Yeah. So I sent you the email. I forwarded the email about all the houses that are going in now. We're looking for comments for Lowell Street. If you have any, I'll take them down right now, but I'm going to finish off my letter and put it together.
So,
send it.
They're subject to the state regulations, but they don't have to come before us?
They will come before us for the state.
Yeah, they have
yeah.
to, for the notice of intent.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, so they do need a state notice of intent.
They do.
Yeah.
They do have to file it. They have to come before us again.
And also for the town.
Nope. The town is null and void.
They would be exempt from the town bylaws.
Like from zoning, things like that.
And they're exempt from our town wetland bylaw as well.
They are.
Mm-hmm.
They are. The Zoning Board of Appeals has some pressure over them to try to... like whatever we feel is important, they can make that comment, but I think that's not gonna.
Under the State Wetland Protection Act, the setbacks are at the discretion of the local conservation commission, and we have established, in general, the 35 and 25 foot.
Exactly.
And unless there's an overriding reason to abandon that, I see no reason to.
We've basically codified our belief and our experience in Reading that the 25 and 35 is what we believe, and we've put it in writing.
Right.
So that doesn't change.
And the town of Wakefield, for example, does not have separate town wetland bylaws, but they have a memorandum specifying
mm-hmm.
their setbacks.
Mm-hmm.
And this would be applicable. So everything else being equal, and there's some overriding reason, it makes sense to stick with those things.
The only thing that we were holding their feet to the fire for was that buffer zone around
the vernal pool.
The vernal pool, which we lose going with just the state. We lose that wording that we have in our.
We do.
Room.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, there's still 100-foot buffers on around
there
the
is.
Pool, just
there
like
is.
There's around any reason.
You're gonna lose the infiltration area, and you're gonna lose that buffer zone because they'll just do a superseding order. so.
How do you know they will?
You think the superseding order is gonna be ruled against the local commission?
Well, we'll find out, you know, an upcoming DRT meeting, and but I think they're proposing more houses, and I think everything gets closer. This is what I've heard, that they're a lot closer than the 25-foot line now with what they're trying to do.
But we still have, we could still.
So that's their alternative.
Yeah.
Well, we could still hypothetically not issue the order of conditions, in other words, deny it, and then they'd have to appeal to the DEP.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
And does DEP doesn't often rule against the local commission. I mean, if we said.
Sometimes they do.
Yeah.
It depends on how justified the order of conditions is.
I mean, you know, if you think of how we've ruled over the last, at least the time I've been here, you know, we're very clear as to what's.
We've been challenged, though, and DEP has ruled against us.
Twice that I know of. Goddard School.
The canal.
And maybe Strawberry Lane, too, but I can't remember for sure.
I can't remember.
So.
But I think this is more cut and dried, if you're, you know, coming into this, you know, 25-foot zone.
Well, we'll see. Are they within 25 feet right now?
We haven't seen a plan. We're just putting comments together based on, I guess there was a site walk that I couldn't get to. So that probably would have spelled it out a little bit better. And what I got from Jesse was they're moving everything a little bit closer. More houses, more density. They blamed, they said that this would be a stream, in a sense, they said this would be a stream, except that there's a culvert underneath the tracks that's been blocked up for years, which has caused the backup, which has caused this wetland. So, I don't know what they do about
that. I mean, using that analogy, then all the interchanges are not wetlands either.
It was that.
I mean, you use that analogy, then none of these interchanges are under jurisdiction either. So you can't use that analogy.
I mean, if it has the vegetation inside.
And actually, there is flow in there. I've witnessed the flow going underneath that river. I've witnessed it.
Well, also the general slope of that of the entire area on that whole, all those neighborhoods on that side of the track is essentially flat.
Yeah.
The streets are flat, the backyards are flat.
I think they'd have a hard
The wetlands
time.
Are flat. I mean, it's not like they're partway, it's not a steep slope to create a drainage channel. You know, a fixed stream bed, you know, it's just all wet area. Yes, controlled by those culverts, but they are free and clear. I could see through them.
Well, that ditch, were you out there? When we were walking around a couple years back or whatever, looking for the.
I've been to that ditch many times.
When we were walking through there, it's deep.
Yeah.
It was up to my waist, just right off the railroad tracks.
Yep.
Oh, did you wade? You wade through it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, we were walking all over.
Will and I went in there with chest waders. We were up to our.
Okay.
When did you
deeper than
when
our
did
knees.
You do that?
After,
I didn't miss all the
last
fun.
February, March.
What the heck?
Was the last
wasn't
year?
That cold?
We're talking
I think
here.
It was more like November.
And then I'll tell you, there's a lot of flow that comes off of Lowell Street into that channel. I
That's
mean,
true.
It shoots out of
It's pretty
pipe.
Blocked up by the abutters on the
but
other side.
According to the state definition, it has saturated soil and wetland vegetation. It's a wetland.
Right. That's what I'm saying. Yeah, that's a hard thing. That's a hard thing to prove. I mean, I'm making that statement.
I mean, the wetland line is what it is.
It is
so
what it
we've
is,
already
yeah.
kind of approved
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
We're just gonna stick to
yeah.
that,
yeah.
And there's not gonna
oh,
be.
Oh, we
any
issued a
NRAD.
NRAD.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah, we did.
So that habitat is something that's a bylaw thing, and the state doesn't agree with that. So
that's
one of those things that we're gonna have to worry about.
But the you know natural vegetation, all that is at the discretion of the commission.
Well, we've already agreed on the wetland line, so that's that.
No, but I'm saying,
I don't think that would have moved anyways. It's kind of
right.
Pretty obvious.
Yeah, it's pretty obvious.
Okay.
So the only question is, how close to that wetland line,
right.
wetland line, do we approve a structure or disturb it?
Yeah.
That's the question, basically. I mean, there's some stormwater things and whatnot, but that's the basic question.
Yeah, it was.
And generally speaking, I mean, the only way we've, in most of the cases, it seems to me, we've allowed some variance from the 35 or 25 foot if it's a pre-existing lawn structure or, you know, if it's already established.
This is not.
And this is not. It's all. It's except for that house near the
right.
Well,
near Lowell Street. The rest of the lot is.
The applicant
forested.
Made the case that that stormwater structure was going on redevelopment or some sort of existing development area, and there was only a portion that wasn't on top of that. So that's what he was saying about that stormwater structure. It was just that house in the back that was within 50 feet of.
Right.
The whatever the edge of the wetland,
yeah. Right.
And it was habitat, which is 100 feet.
Yeah. So what redevelopment of what of the paved parking of the road of the driveway?
Well, there is some sort of dirt or you know gravel
right.
out in that area,
yep.
And that's
it's
where
like
the infiltration was going to be,
yep.
And that
yeah.
the what is the detention pond? I don't know what he was
yeah.
he had in mind, but he had some sort of you know. Low impact something or other going on out there, and I think even the garage on the existing house, Bill was saying that he sees no place for it.
Right.
It can't move any
right.
forward, so I don't think that was the sticking point.
No.
I think it was just the stormwater structure and the house in the back.
Yeah. So this letter you're drafting,
now
it's going to DEP.
It's more. No, sorry.
It was part of the cul-de-sac. It was in 35 feet.
There was, yeah, the turnaround because it had to be wide enough for one of the fire trucks, and there was a portion of that in there, and that was way up the end. But that wasn't like the stormwater structure, which was very deep in it,
yeah.
Like the 25-foot line. So we can pull out those old plans, but that's what I remember about it.
So this letter's going to DEP?
No, it's just something the town is going to put together and say, these are the input we got from all the... committees,
okay.
And
so it's even before a DRT.
It's more like bullet points. So I put one together for 1503 Main Street way back when. It's just a bunch of bullet points saying this is what we think. And there's a lot of stuff that I can gain from the meeting that we had already on this. So
I mean, we can say as a commission, we can say, you know, 35 feet. We
no.
can't reference our bylaw, but if that's our belief that 35 feet is the amount of the area that you need to protect that resource area and to give us enough assurance that the resource area will not be altered, that has nothing to do with a bylaw. It has everything to do with what we believe as a commission.
Yeah, well, we should say that.
Why not?
Anybody know any reason why?
Why
we
not?
Should?
Why shouldn't we? I mean, that's what we believe, and that's why the bylaw is the way it is, but it's unrelated to
well,
being a bylaw.
To me, it doesn't seem site-specific as a number. You know, it just seems like this is the number we've been using as
right.
part of the bylaw,
right. Right.
And it's what we've stuck with as precedent. Therefore, in our history, it's the most justified. But if we're looking at the actual property, if that 35-foot was never in our bylaw, and we looked at this property from
might
scratch.
Be 50.
You know, we should say what we should say for the property,
well,
because
what,
that's going to be just as justified as the 35 foot.
Well, what's
because
happened
we're not looking at the bylaw.
What's happened is that the courts have approved, as in the Wakefield and other cases, that establishing. A lawn, a number of feet is justifiable.
For establishing a lawn?
A line.
A
line.
Line.
A line that you do not have to come up with justification for the setback on every
okay.
single application. You can refer to your standard procedure. Now you can adapt or amend or modify it in a particular case, but to stick with the standard procedure, that's acceptable. And what I think Brian's suggesting I would support is that we tell the developer that that's our standard. If
you need to plan it this or expect to have problems.
Plan this or justify
yep.
any variation
yep.
from it to us.
Yep.
And if they can make a case that
yep.
In this particular situation, 33.2 feet is fine. We'll certainly listen to that argument. But I think we should let them know that's.
Yeah, let them design to it, yeah.
Yeah.
Or
make their case.
So where did you base the 35 feet?
We came up with it for the bylaw.
For this particular project, why did you go with 35 feet?
I'm saying our standard procedure is 35 feet, and that's what we expect this project to adhere to.
Because in our experience, 35 feet is what we believe to protect our resource areas in Reading.
We don't, every case, come up with what the setback should be. We start with 35 feet. Sometimes, I can't remember any, but sometimes we must have required more, and in others we've required less. Start with 35 feet.
I can even go further to tell you that if you're designing a curbless system, this is just sort of as an aside, if you're designing a curbless system for a parking lot, let's say, the DP runoff manual tells you need to have a vegetated buffer strip of 25 feet or greater before you get to your BMP. Otherwise, that would be considered pretreatment enough to get to that BMP. A vegetated buffer strip needs to be at least 25 feet, and then there's some slope requirements in there as well. It can't be more than so many percent in slope. So, that being said, you know, that's even written down in the DEP manual, the 25 feet of vegetated buffer strip is
sufficient.
It's protection for a BMP, so.
I see.
Well, the other thing, if in the hypothetical case we denied a permit somewhere, not here, but anywhere, we denied a permit and it was appealed to DEP, they would want to know how you came up with that setback. And if we came up with a setback of 27.6 feet, they'd say, how the hell did you justify that?
Well,
but if we
right.
said we came up with a setback of 35 feet, because that's what we used in all the other cases, and it's proved over time to be protected, the DEP
yep.
said, oh, okay,
that's
I
it.
Understand that.
That's it.
It's not arbitrary and capricious.
Right.
It's justifiable. Now, if we want to come up with a different number here, we could. But we have to document
right.
why.
Yes.
Whereas with the 35 feet, we really don't have to document why, other than to say, over time, it's found to be protective and it's found to be what
okay.
we've applied.
Okay. I just wanted to hear that discussion.
There may be a case where 20 or 25
sure.
would work because they offer more
right.
protection over here or whatever.
Right, right.
But
I think we should let them know that 35 feet is our 35 feet no build, 25% natural zone natural vegetation is what we would expect to see.
Or an explanation.
Are most people in agreement with that?
I think it's reasonable.
Okay.
We can explain why we chose it. Like, Terry's
okay.
the same place. So
yeah.
That's probably
okay.
So can we let them know that, Chuck?
Right, so this first letter is just going to the town. We're going to package them all up, and then I think they send them off to DEP, or maybe it's, I don't know what the next step is. But.
Doesn't it go to the developer?
No, because the developer is petitioning the state to have a 40B project, and he has to get that first. And we're saying this is why we don't think he should be allowed to have one.
Oh,
and why don't
case.
We think, well, we can't say with that same plans that we don't think he should have one.
Well, we're going to say things like you guys just put out there. Like,
oh,
you know,
well, in that case,
we have
need
a vernal,
to say,
we have a potential vernal pool out
we
there, we
that.
Have our setbacks.
We need to say about the habitat. We
the
need
habitat,
to talk about that
right.
then. Yeah.
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 What else do you anticipate saying from a CONCOM statement?
I think you can say it's there's a good portion of it that's existing established habitat.
Yeah, right. Right.
I mean the main things is we have the wetland line and we have
yeah.
our buffer zones or our jurisdictional
yeah.
setbacks, the 25 and the 35 foot. I mean, I think that's the big point. Then we have that habitat from the potential vernal pool.
Well, documented evidence for a
Will
and I
Will submitted the
so we need to put all that
I spoke to Will on Sunday about that and he said they rejected it because he had insufficient evidence.
Really?
Now his recent observations down there. I let him know that this was back on, and if he could get any additional data, that would be helpful. He said when he was down there, where he did hear a lot of croaking, a lot of wood frogs chorusing, was not in that area there, but across in the larger wetland.
On the other side of the tracks?
No, on the same side of the track, but in the wetlands.
On the other side of
closer
the street.
Towards the Pean.
Yeah, the other side of the street there.
The other side of the short street.
Right. Right.
Plymouth.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
so there's a larger
expected.
Wetland area.
That's expected, yeah.
And that, you know, and so that if the area at this property is a vernal pool, it might be acting as marginally.
Let's don't say anything in our letter about vernal pool.
Yeah, exactly.
Don't say anything about it, because if we say that,
but I can say
denied it.
Habitat with wood frogs chorusing nearby.
Because
they do.
But that was really where I was going to go. I was going to hit those three things. If you had any other suggestions.
25.
Setbacks.
Yep.
We established the edge, and you know, the structures have to be out of 35, and it's a zone of natural vegetation, and the fact that we are very close to agreeing on this situation, but very close to, you know, I think the stormwater structure was very close to.
Yeah, but that's referring to a previous plan. We
right.
can't refer
right.
to a previous plan.
Okay.
What we have to do is demonstrate that this site is environmentally sensitive.
And what its values are.
Important wetland resource. And that given the our established setbacks from the resource area, there's very little developable land. I think that's what we need to say. We can't refer to the other plans.
Right, right. This is going to be much different.
Right, much different.
Yeah. I'll add those things. I mean, flood control,
yeah. Stormwater.
Just go through the interests and
yeah.
figure out which
yeah.
one works. I mean,
they all do. Well, a good portion of them do.
I don't know.
You know, they have a good opportunity there to put more flood storage in there as part of this project.
They were doing that.
They really
gonna,
do.
They were going to clean that out.
They really do.
Okay.
So, we'll see.
Okay. Good luck.
It's not much.
But I don't know what else we can. I mean, it's not riverfront. It's not
old growth. No, it's not that. I think that's it. I think it's really the habitat. I think it's the flood control, which is obvious. But
that vernal pool thing got rejected. Why didn't they resubmit?
They wanted better recordings, and what else did he say? Better recordings and...
Better recordings is what he told me.
Something about eggs. Did he say anything about finding...
He didn't mention that.
No,
there were two things.
Maybe the applicant come back and say, yeah, guess what? It's not a vernal pool, so now we want to submit this plan again.
Right. Well,
and
we'll see what,
you know?
We'll see what happens.
Yeah, I don't...
You mean the plan for the four houses?
Right.
Yeah, I mean, if it's not... I mean... We submitted the evidence, and they said, no, it's not. There's not enough evidence. And if we don't have the evidence that it's not a vernal pool, why don't they resubmit the plan again?
They could have followed up on that.
Yeah.
They wanted to, but
well, they were still within 35 feet, the old plan.
Right, right. But, I mean, one of the major things was this vernal pool habitat issue.
Yep.
So,
right.
Anyway, that was just an aside. I'm just saying, I mean, if that was the sticking point to losing that house, you know, losing that whole building lot, and now it's technically not, you know, according to the submitted evidence. This
okay.
is a very expensive process for them, 40B.
Well, we'll see what comes next.
Yeah.
You mean
we're not driving it forward.
Filing fees or engineering fees?
Everything, yeah. I mean, it's not easy to do a 40B. It's very adversarial, too. So.
Okay, so portable classrooms, unless there's any more. more comments on the.
I reviewed all the sites for the portable classrooms and found none of them within 100 feet of a jurisdictional wetland.
Awesome.
Sounds good to me.
Okay. Proposed gas line relay.
Did you get that? This guy wants to just be allowed to work on, and I'm worried about a precedent.
So this is the April 8th letter?
Yeah.
From, okay, so April 8th letter from.
They want to do a relay.
Andrew Shelby. They want to replace gas line on Forest Street, Forest Glen Road.
Forest Street and Forest Glen Road.
They're working within 100-foot buffer zone.
That's up there by the old,
Near Birch Meadow.
Nursery,
Goes past
Bethune. What's the nursery on Main Street that's now gonna be a, dimension unit?
You got it, Brian?
Eric's.
Eric's.
It's two there, I could need one.
They're gonna need a permit, right?
I think so.
Within 100 feet?
I thought it was funny how he cited, 10-2-1B?
What is 2A?
10-2-2A-2.
Yeah.
What's that?
CMR?
Not substantially change or enlarge an existing and lawfully located structure or facility using the service of public and used to provide electric or gas services are exempt from regulation under MGL 13140, provided said work utilizes the best practical measures to avoid or minimize impacts to wetland resources outside of the footprint of said structure or facility. So that's the, you know, telephone lines, communication, water.
Did you check that to see if he's right, Chuck?
I did. I went through it a couple times. Can you say that number again? 10-2 what?
It's 310 CMR 10-02-2A-2.
It's kind of like the Army Corps General permit, is what it is. Sounds like.
Mm-mm.
I mean, allowing repair to existing utilities.
Yeah.
So,
I mean,
but don't just Brian. Don't you find it like?
Aren't they limited projects?
No, these are exempt.
No, they're exempt. Yeah, utility service for the public good is exempt.
But it's only maintenance of existing.
Correct.
It's not new.
Not substantial enlargement.
Right.
An existing roadway. So what he's doing is they're talking about the resource area, but it's a lot of buffer zone work too. So this is the resource area.
But he's
exemption.
Working in the resource area.
So I thought that was funny that he was.
I thought he was in a paved right-of-way.
They was using that.
Yeah,
he's
yes.
in a paved
oh, no.
right-of-way. He's
right.
not in the jurisdiction.
No, he's
there.
Not.
He's not in the paved right-of-way.
He is in a paved right-of-way.
He is. He is, but, you know, like, if the culvert's not 200 foot long, you know, I mean, you could. I called him up and I asked him a couple of questions about this because he wrote that letter in the first place, and he said, we had something in our bylaw, and I said, well, where is this? And he said, well, actually, you just didn't say that it can't be done.
Ha!
So.
Your issue is he's just quoting something that you don't think applies?
My issue is that this will come up a lot, and do we want to review every, you know, cut and fill here in town, or do we want to let some of these go like this one here that's in the center of the roadway? It's always up to you guys. What do you want to do?
He just says it's be in the 100-foot buffer zone or within 200 feet of an open water body. But it's in the road, right?
I mean, it does. It's
yeah, but this is essentially the same thing that we just approved an RDA for today.
No,
that was
a new gas line.
It was brand new.
Yeah, that's
brand
like an
new.
Extension.
Nothing in there.
But
now.
It was cutting and paving. I mean, the mechanics of it.
Doesn't matter.
It is, but it's not exempt because it's new.
Right.
So even though they're doing the functionally, even though they're doing the exact same thing, it's the intent. It's.
Well, the theory is that the land's already disturbed, there's already a gas line in there, they're just replacing it.
Yeah, this is just right in Forest Street. It goes across Main Street, Forest Glen Road, and Forest Street on either side of Main Street. And they're putting it in the street, in the paved area. They're going to abandon the steel line in place and put the plastic line in.
cap and abandon the steel line.
RDA or you know, and then are the rest of them going to be reviewed?
Well, where's the resource exactly? Can you go up to?
It's that same wetland there, Street.
Is this on
I don't know if
Forest
any other
Street?
Resource area there.
Like right in this area here?
Yep, it goes.
It's Forest Street, so it's.
Right
it
here?
Starts at.
It's.
It starts at just before Rice Road, which is to the west.
This isn't Rice.
Which one's Rice?
Where's Hurlburt?
Here's Bethune.
Van Norden.
That's Bethune.
Colburn down by Hurlburt. Keep going.
It's a long
right,
God,
right.
A
see
long.
Rice Road.
Yep.
Right there. It actually starts right at, is it Martin Road? What is the road right up top there?
Martin.
Starts at the base.
Starts at
Martin.
Bill's Road there.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Wow. And then goes all the way to Main Street.
So you're close right here.
It goes to Main Street, goes across Main Street to
goes
Pearl.
Across Main Street to Pearl.
Ends at Pearl Street.
We have right here where we just had that, we just permitted this house here. And this is
that's
Bethune.
Bethune.
Yep.
Yep. That's an awful lot of.
Long way.
How many?
I don't see any resource area yet, though.
But it's the storm drains go into the resource area, is what it is.
And
they have like a comprehensive plan, or not comprehensive, but detailed plan of what they were going to do. I don't know whether it's good enough in regards to that, but.
How far up Forest Glen do they go, Brian?
Just a Pearl.
They ended that like weird triangle stop sign thing.
Yep.
Right by the cemetery.
I see it.
And they're showing, you know, BMP silt sacks and
other than that one culvert, I don't see any resource here.
And this is, you know, they probably do. I don't know how long it's going to take them, but they probably do. I don't know. They probably do 20, 30, 40 feet in a day or something. You know, they move right along, so.
Do you think anyone along this road has the right to know about it?
1,000 feet? In a day?
No, not a day.
Oh.
I'm saying in total. I'm hoping if they only do more than 20 feet a day.
No, I think
one
it's
thing that makes
feet,
me
right.
a little cautious about this is, you know, what happened on West Street.
Yeah, you're right. It's more than 20 feet a day.
It has to be like a month.
Yeah.
I mean, they're going to dig a 3-foot trench.
Do they say anything about dewatering?
No.
No.
It's pretty shallow.
3 feet, yeah.
Yeah, West Street was a lot deeper than 3 feet.
Yeah.
It was a lot deeper in some locations.
This is a pretty. I would really.
Keep in mind, they don't have to maintain grade or anything.
No.
Like
nope. They just follow it. It's quick.
This is where we're at. This seems to be the only.
That's the only issue. And I assume that stream's in a culvert under 4th Street.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, it is, definitely.
Down that one that she presented, they were going to do 200 feet in 2 days.
Yeah.
So.
And
that includes services, too.
Yeah.
Which will probably have to connect to services here as well.
So,
yes,
so 4 weeks.
The way all the
time. A month.
Yeah, probably, yeah.
Stormwater permit map. Let's see what sort of outfalls are there. But for that amount of work, I don't know. I just.
Yeah, so I asked George what the policy was ever in this town, and he said they've always got permits.
Yeah.
But Pete didn't agree with it, but he did say they always got permits. Can't remember not getting a permit for this type of work or any type of work in Reading.
Permit from DPW?
From us.
From us.
So what about
what about near Dunbar Road? Where's Where's Bethune?
Right here.
Where's Dunbar?
No, there's definitely a resource area, that we're going with. They're gonna be in the 100-foot buffer zone.
Left, yeah. So there's wetlands within 100 feet of the road at Dunbar. No, like just to the, just west of Dunbar.
Yeah, I see down here.
So if you move a little bit west.
Oh, yeah, 'cause that's.
Yeah, you see that little.
Right there?
Yeah.
I think we.
There's an outfall to the left.
Didn't we allow some trees to be taken down on 170 Forest?
Yeah, I remember most of their backyard, actually.
Yeah, in the back.
So you guys were out there.
Yeah, I remember that. You were out there.
I was there.
Yeah.
Is that the one with the willow that they took down? I'm thinking of it.
There were a lot of trees that were looking not healthy in the backyard, but.
Oh, I know. Yeah, I remember that one.
Yeah.
I remember that one.
So,
what's your question before us?
Did they need a permit?
They need a permit, and are we going to allow this type of work? Because this is the gate, I guess.
Well, from what I've heard tonight, they don't need a state permit, but do they need a wetland, a redding?
Right.
Do you, yeah. Are they going to go out there and do it on their own, or is there going to be some sort of control on it from the Conservation Commission? And there's control on it, I mean, obviously with the enforcement orders if something happened, things like that, but.
And apparently, according to the regulation, it does say that they need to follow.
Best management.
They need to, right, they need to follow the best management practices.
So they're not covered under a state permit, I think.
You don't think?
Well, according to the exemption they cited, so.
Right.
But you checked that exemption, they were just making it up, right?
No.
That's a resource area exemption, that, the buffer zone exemption, I was looking at that one, and it didn't seem to have, anything for utilities.
Well, if they're.
I would think if it's exempt from the resource area.
They're exempt from the buffer zone.
It's just common sense.
Unfortunately, common
sense. Just reading it.
So common.
I know.
Online.
I think some sort of permit from the town should be needed.
Well, I like to see it in writing, but.
Well,
but
I hear you.
My
opinion.
I hear you.
In the jurisdictional area, they're in the buffer zone.
To qualify for that exemption, they need to be working in the resource area. That's
okay,
how,
so let's make them go right through the middle
reads,
of the
right? So if they're working in the buffer zone, where do they hang their hat? That's like a strict constructionist view of it. But no, I get it.
Do we require 10?
Well, let me ask you this. How would they file with the town?
They can do that.
But how? Well, like how? Would they just send a letter? Or?
No, there's a.
You check
we've
on.
We've done this before.
Yeah, it's like you check on. So C and D has changed. So D is actually if you're in the buffer zone or the resource area. And C has turned into do you need to file? Is this application qualify for a wetlands permit or something? Whatever it says. But those are the two now. So they would check off C and D or just C.
C being the 10 bylaws.
No, C is the state. Do you need a wetlands permit? And then the other one is, are you likely to alter the wetlands if you're working in the resource area or if you're working in the buffer? So.
Yeah, but what we're talking about, how do you file for just the 10 and not the state? And I know there's a way to do it because people.
You would check off D, in my opinion.
Is there a D?
There is. It's the one. Is the work likely to alter? Is the work located in the buffer zone likely to alter the resource area, or is the work in the resource area likely to alter it? Something to that effect.
Okay, so I mean, one thing they're
why,
saying.
Yeah.
One thing they're saying here, though, is so the quote they say, activities conducted to not substantially change or enlarge an existing structure. And here they're, I mean, it's minor, but they're changing from 6-inch steel to 12-inch plastic.
Aha.
That is four times the flow. When you double the diameter, you quadruple
so,
the capacity.
Not necessarily because of the pressure.
Yeah, that's true.
Okay.
And the steel
yeah, but they didn't get into
a lot
it.
More
okay.
pressure.
They didn't get into it.
Engineers, stop.
So it's my opinion that I'd like to see them file an RDA.
I think it's safe to say double the diameter is at least double the flow. So I think that that's a significant increase in capacity.
So any other opinions out here to help give Chuck some guidance?
Why don't we just make him file under the tab?
Right.
I
think
that's the only thing we can ask them to do. I don't think we can ask them to file under the state.
Yeah.
I can ask him, but I don't know.
So do you, what are the opinions of other people? Do you think...
Yeah, I think
long stretch.
I think
yes,
if they come in and they discuss
like
the project with us,
yeah.
and I think that makes sense.
Yeah.
To the best of my knowledge, we don't have that exemption in the 10 bylaws, so I don't think they have a choice.
Okay.
He even confirmed that we don't have the exemption. He said that we didn't.
So somebody actually
read
the regulations.
Work.
I'm shocked.
He did.
It seemed like
he
did. When I asked him, I said, "Where is it?" He goes, "Well, you actually just." Didn't say that you had to file for these projects.
Okay.
I mean the
so maybe that would be another change if when we open up, when we start working on the bylaw that we could make, if people thought that that was needed.
It says the bylaw provides anything. It says right in the letter. I don't know if he said that that's not correct, but it says right here that it does provide an exemption.
No, he said he's going to modify. Yeah, no, he's I just had a sense that this guy was just saying whatever, you know, I'm not paying attention, but I recognized his name from another project, so I
don't think it's
okay.
too much to ask him to come in and go over the project.
It's, you know, there's a bigger question, too. Do you want to review any of these type of projects? So any kind of
yeah.
cut and cover inside the roadway, we're going to either say, don't bother us, or...
If it's replacing or repairing existing pipe inside existing...
Yeah, I think it should be covered.
Road pipe, roadway, I don't think we need to look at it.
Did you just say you wanted to see it?
I'm saying I don't think we need to.
Okay.
If it's a culvert, that's a different story, because that directly involves a resource
yeah.
area.
Yeah, oh.
So we're only grabbing this one because they're increasing the size of the pipe.
No, we're only grabbing this one because the TAN doesn't have an exemption for replacing existing utilities.
Oh, so you were talking about the state when you said we don't need to review.
But
I don't think he has to file under the state
from
what we were reading.
But what Chuck is saying is, you know, if we tell, you know, this is sort of really a precedent.
Precedent,
you know,
yeah.
And if we ask him in, then all of them are going to have to come in.
Oh, we can stop on the next one. But my question was twofold. Do you think this should be looked at? It sounds like yes, under the bylaw. And if it was no, can I just start letting everybody work in the street as long as they follow the BMPs? And
you know what he might be able to do is file a minor project under
the TAN.
Not necessarily this one, but in general.
Yeah.
Somebody
yeah.
who wanted to do something like this could file some minor.
I was
project.
Thinking about that, yeah, because you have pavement separating. It's a small amount of disturbance, you know.
Okay.
Because I think just letting existing utilities be worked on, you know, that could open a can of worms.
Yeah.
Granted, it is the town mostly. I mean, the only you're gonna have the gas company that's gonna be separate, but most of the other utilities are gonna be done with
water,
the town.
Water,
sewer, but that really makes a mess. With those projects, you can really make a mess if you're replacing a sewer or water. You can have pretty big cuts for that stuff.
But their general permit probably covers that we just passed.
Probably.
All right.
But they have to know.
I have to push you guys along.
Member contact.
We're running out of time here.
I agree.
Does everyone
see what you've missed, Allison?
Yeah.
Allison.
I just thought I wasn't here at the time when I wasn't for the 1 a.m. thing. I didn't
twice.
Fall asleep. I don't fall asleep.
I thought you fell asleep when you dropped your glasses.
No, they just kept falling out of my pocket.
She was nodding off.
No, I would never do that. Are you kidding me?
I'm not that tired. No, they just keep falling out because like there's too much crap in my pockets.
I don't think anyone thinks you're falling asleep.
Just giving you a hard time.
Oh, I'm all done. This is my last term. 6:30:15.
I saw that.
Are you gonna read?
So let me.
I haven't decided yet. Wait a minute. How soon is that? That's just pretty.
It's like
coming
two
up.
Months. Two
three
months.
Meetings.
Yep. Yeah. Right. Right. It's only like two meetings away we've been meeting.
Please update the emergency permit.
Yep, this is an old emergency permit. It's been lost a couple of times, but if you guys sign that,
okay.
That's for.
It's already been done.
Forest Glen Circle.
Okay. Do we need to vote?
You
it says
vote
ratify.
It. Yeah, they're just ratifying it. On a water and sewer bill on Pearl Street,
again.
We were paying too much. So
yay.
That's 16.
I can't remember
something
what we were
was
like.
Too
it was
much?
40 something, and it got knocked down to 20. That was a one-time
you
reduction, though.
To keep a copy of this, Brian. Did you get a copy?
Oh, you're supposed
to
take a copy
for each one of them.
Is there?
Oh.
Or you can just write down what you.
I'd like a copy.
Any changes? Hand it back to me. I'll make a master copy and send it out to people.
But there's six copies here.
I'd rather have
any changes
copy.
On it.
You'd rather have what?
Electronic copy. I'm just gonna recycle this.
I'll take one.
So
no, seriously. I mean, because that's how I refer to it. Because I'll never find
it. Get this?
If I take that home, I'll never find it.
If you have a change.
Do we have an electronic copy?
Yeah.
We can.
Chuck has it.
I know. Do
we
have
it? We will.
I don't think so. Not yet. Coming.
We have changes.
We have to make these changes first. There are none yet. Let me know, Rebecca,
any changes?
If you make
what
any.
About Allison, don't you have a new email
you
address?
You have
it's
her Gmail.
There.
You took out the UNH one,
there.
So.
We don't have your
use that
one. No, I don't. Well, I mean, I still get the emails.
What is it?
And I respond to people, but I always forget to reply
me?
All.
7 7 8
so I only
7
send it to like one person.
Nine.
Is my problem.
7 1 8 9
I never hit reply all because I'm always getting emails
617?
From like a million people.
Yes.
Okay.
Boston.
Especially on my
screen. Gotcha.
9 6 1 7 1
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Hey, what else?
Your stuff.
Okay, administrator's report.
Wasn't it
senior living?
Brian, you
enforcement.
Yeah. So
or
we did.
Copy as you.
Art of senior living is going to start up again.
Did it get back to Chuck? Did the corrected one get back to Chuck?
Was there a
didn't
corrected
you,
one?
Didn't
change
you
anything?
Make the changes?
I don't see any changes.
617, you said.
784.
Let's finish
seven,
one thing.
7 1 8 9
617 784 7 1 8 9 Please.
There is a change.
Sorry.
How soon are you gonna read up?
I haven't decided yet. It's kind of whether or not I move. Kind of depending.
Okay.
So trying to figure all that out, but I don't
where
know.
Where might you move?
Into the city.
Where?
Okay. Into the city, like Brighton, Austin.
That's a
there.
Good plan.
Nice.
Okay.
I don't really live at my parents' house anymore.
Jager.
That's a good plan.
Stop
so it
kind
of depends. If like my some of my friends are trying to move to Colorado, so it's kind of like if they're leaving, then I'm gonna get into their spot. So.
All right. Let us know.
So well, yeah.
I may have to re-sign up, otherwise it won't be a quorum. And then the Board of Selectmen will have to be the Conservation Commission.
You got it.
I know. What,
so
what are we doing about
they may
that?
Force me to stay on.
What are we doing? I mean, about getting more members.
Well, we are networking with as many people as possible, talking to them at the train station and in our offices and everywhere we can. Because everybody feels this urgency here that we can't make meetings and we're not covering the work we need to cover.
Asked the selectmen to.
It's on the front page.
We have not officially asked selectmen, but we've gotten word out.
Au contraire, I sent them an email.
You sent them an email. I've mentioned things to Jean. I've. Yeah,
it's
going to
go in.
We've talked to people in town hall.
Whatever that thing's called, the Florida's paper.
The bi-weekly
paper is.
Report or something, yeah.
So.
Well, there have been. there have been times when committees have been short, critically short of people, as we are. And what the selectmen have done when people came to apply for positions on town committees.
They say we need.
They say somebody came from the finance committee and there was one slot and there were four people that applied. They told the other three people the committees that needed to be populated. And they basically told them, you go do the Conservation Commission and do your penance there, and then you can come back and get on the finance committee.
Right, right.
That's what we need here, because we need some people to sit in these chairs.
That actually happened when I applied for the commission a while ago. Actually, it was just the opposite.
You were an associate member for a while.
I was an associate member because Brian Tucker and I applied at the same time, and I took him instead.
Yeah.
And then when I came, when someone left, I got on, there was two, myself and someone else. And since it was my second time, they told him, oh, we need help in this committee. Would you be happy to do that? And,
right.
And so he did that. So.
Right.
Add it to your talk on Tuesday night.
Will do.
Am I going to get a letter by tomorrow? Is this?
Yeah.
Like,
you're going to get one
like
at like
1 o'clock
in the morning.
Okay.
What's this letter about?
She's just.
We already talked about it.
Yeah.
It's a selectmen's meeting on Tuesday.
It's for the Timonex Swamp. She's just going to say we approve the signs.
It's just going to summarize all of our meetings and give them the short and sweet why they should go ahead and approve
those
signs.
Oh, then I guess I don't know what it was about. That we're approving the signs and saying that we have the blessing of the friends group that you know, inhabit the area around.
I don't want to go backwards on the agenda. I want to move forward. So
more of that. Let's go.
Yeah, all right. So administrator's report.
Yeah, it's you now.
Artist senior living site visit.
Me.
No, it's
so is anything going to happen at Artists?
They're starting. They're going to start
starting.
On that retaining wall in the back. We did a site walk and we did a DRT meeting. You know, it's kind of these things where he paid his some bill, $70,000 for, can't remember, some sewage bill, something or other, whatever they call that thing. But he hadn't paid our bond.
Betterment.
Do you know what it is? What's it called?
Betterment. Sewer betterment.
No, it wasn't called that.
No.
But I don't know what it was. But again, it was a big number. He paid that. He didn't pay ours. And they expect to move forward soon.
Okay,
they're still picking
good.
Contractors for the site. There's no one chosen, but Lynch is going to do the wall and back.
Wow.
And they're the same contacts for the project, and they're staying in touch with you?
Yes.
Okay.
So.
Lynch, they're a pretty big firm.
Okay.
Build the wall.
3 weeks.
Stuff in Bedford.
3 weeks till start?
I&I. Does that sound familiar to anyone? I&I, the I&I payment?
There's an I&I
infiltration
payment?
And...
Something. Yeah, something
inflow
like that. There's an I&I assessment.
If they're connecting to a sewer that has I&I, they have to pay to replace certain amount of the
So there's an I&I assessment based on, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that was what it was.
Okay. Enforcement for Scotland and Dustin.
Yeah, Scotland Road. So anyways, the land trust sold Scotland Road to the abutter, and the abutter is basically turning this into a European forest by picking up all the debris and raking up the leaves and putting trails in there and building things. And he's been seen on several occasions when we're working on West Street to be pumping out the wetland. And
right.
he was talked to
into
by the engineering department.
We talked to him about that months ago.
In person?
We talked about it here.
We talked about it here, but...
Send
but
a letter. Did we ever send him a letter?
I think it's
we,
kind of...
So, what I did was I contacted the chair of the land trust, who told me that there was something on his deed. So we finally got back to each other like today. So there's something on the deed that tells him how the land is supposed to be kept in its natural state, something like that. I want to get that. I didn't know that before, but I suspected it. I'm going to get that. I'm adding it to the letter, and I'll send it to these people.
Okay.
So.
But we talked about this. It was 6-8 months ago.
Right, and that's.
And nothing ever happened, because he was pumping the wetlands out at that time.
When we first started talking about West Street, I did put it on the agenda for people to understand that something was happening. It could have been a one-time event, but it doesn't seem like that now. It seems
He's
like
pumping
it's a
the
chronic
wetland
problem.
Into the catch basin, so it's like a big circle.
Yeah,
he's pumping it out of the wetland into the catch basin.
Their lawyer told them that there wasn't a wetland out there.
Right. We had this discussion. And I thought we voted on some action.
Sending a letter.
Yeah.
We did. Pretty sure.
Well, that's fine.
Yeah. No,
there's
I
many
know,
steps
but here's
before you
update.
Write a letter. I was getting the deed talking to the land trust guy, all right? The letter's still going out there.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's been many months.
Yeah. So
and that discussion didn't talk about the deed restriction, it just talked about the illegal pump water out of wetland.
This is not gonna be simple. I needed to build a case, and I knew that. So this is not a letter, and they're even going to pay attention.
Well, Jeff, you should have told us at the time, because we voted on an action. If we go on an action, it doesn't happen. We're wasting our time.
No, you're not. The letter doesn't have to be written in 2 seconds. You know, I can.
Yeah, but how about 8 months? I mean, when we vote to write a letter, do we have to put a date on it? I mean, we can do that.
I think it's just in to do the job effectively, it's, you know, get the right background material to produce the letter. If you say there was supposed to be a letter, that's fine, because we had a lot of these things going on that we're monitoring.
Is this letter just going to address the pumping or the clearing at the understory?
It's going to address everything. And it's the understory, the pumping, the fact that it's on his deed.
Well, if the deed, we don't have any responsibility or jurisdiction. So I think we leave that up to the land trust. But the pumping the water out of the wetland is a violation of the Dan bylaw and the state wetland.
If the deed has a restriction on it that says you're not supposed to do any of this stuff, then it should be mentioned. That's what he's saying about the deed.
I mean, if,
well,
if
you
we
know,
want to, but we should not wait on that. We should go ahead with the Wetland Protection Act.
A letter isn't gonna. So we're writing letters all the time, Jamie. You know that. My problem with this is we're writing letters left and right, but we're not doing anything when they come in here. So
I was taking
my time on this one. To me, you know, we've been dealing with Dustin Road for a long time too. So. I'm not apologizing for holding off on the letter.
We've got enforcement issues in town. We've got enforcement issues. We don't seem to have the teeth to, I don't know, scare people sufficiently into complying voluntarily. So,
Well, the first step is to issue an enforcement action.
And
we typically do is send a letter saying, if you don't do this, we're going to issue an enforcement action. We usually are lenient to that point. And I'm good with that. I think it's the way what we should be doing.
So, Scotland Road, the next steps are...
I'm just going to send him a letter. Do you want him to come to a meeting? You just want to just inform them that they can't be doing it?
I think we need to see them at a meeting.
Okay. That's a standard letter. But you don't think I should put the language in the deed or put the deed in it?
I think that backup is important.
I think we absolutely should.
Yeah.
If we have it, yes.
99% of people don't read their deeds.
If we have that, I think that would be good to include in the letter. But I wouldn't hold off the letter waiting to get that confirmation.
Yeah.
And we can copy the land trust on that letter.
But it's not land trust land anymore.
No,
it's this person's land.
It's this person's land.
It
right
is,
now.
But they should be aware that there could be a violation of their transfer of the land.
Well, how would
I think
would
you need to cover everything. I think you need to say it's against state law, it's against bylaw, and it's against your deed to be doing this stuff.
Right. I mean, that's
what everything is.
I think my instinct on this one was that it wasn't going to be easy, so the letter needed to, you know, have more into it than I've put on other ones. So it did take a little bit of time getting through this, but hopefully the result is
and if they
educate them or whatever.
So an initial notification letter? Or an official enforcement letter.
I have gone to that property and talked to the landowner, the missus,
yeah,
who wasn't very happy to hear from me.
Yeah.
So send them an enforcement order then.
So
if they
do
already talk to them, if you already talked
the edges.
To them, then send them an enforcement order.
The thing is, I don't think it's going to be, it's never easy, but this one is going to be absolutely impossible.
You think it's going to be impossible?
From what I'm hearing, they just going to say, you know what? We were told it's none of your damn business.
Well, then we issue an enforcement order. Because we know that's a wetland, it's been designated a wetland.
Well, we also have
years
a minimum,
ago.
We have a minimum size wetland now.
Oh, no, it qualifies for
it
that.
It qualifies? Okay.
Well, that's the whole reason the Land Trust couldn't, they got the land to sell
right.
it as a buildable lot, and they couldn't
right.
do
because
that,
they
so
right.
they
right.
probably gave it away to, you know, at
right.
some price to these
yeah.
people.
Right.
Yeah.
And this, you know.
Yeah. Okay.
See, I don't know if we have jurisdiction to, under the Wetlands Protection Act or the town bylaws, to prevent them from clearing up deadfall wetland. That I don't
or,
know
or
about.
Or filling or anything back there.
Well, filling we do. And pumping water out we do. But picking up dead logs, I'm not sure we can prevent them from doing that. But we can prevent them from pumping the water out or putting fill in.
The deed says it's in a natural state, though.
That would be a deed issue. It's,
right, right.
What about the protection of wildlife habitat?
Well, that's certainly we can make that case, but that's not as strong a case as pumping
right,
out
right,
wetlands
right,
is an obvious,
right, right.
an obvious, and there's plenty of case history on that. You can't pump a wetland out.
So I guess I'm just confused as to what we're arguing about just sending an enforcement or sending a letter, because we're like discussing, and that's good. But I'm just, what's the end goal of the discussion to
well,
figure out what
I
we're
think
doing,
we have
or?
The option of sending an enforcement order. Or just a letter asking them to come in here and tell them that from what we've seen, you're in violation of the State Wetlands Protection Act and bylaws, and come in and let's talk about it.
Yeah, I think
yeah,
that's
I just
one
wasn't
option.
Sure which
we,
what we were
we're
talking
definitely,
about.
Since they haven't received anything yet, it always starts with a letter.
Yeah.
And we're going to build that case, and we're going to get to the enforcement order, and then we're going to get to fines.
Okay.
But we need all that in front of the enforcement order and the fines to actually have them pay the fines.
Yeah. So then
you can, you know.
Why, if we're just gonna, why are we still talking? Like, we already decided we need to do
it's
those
a, it's
steps.
A good point. The letter has to go out,
I mean,
and then we can discuss it after. Because,
I mean,
that.
We're gonna have to talk about it when they're here, because,
right.
okay. you know.
I move we send them a letter asking to attend the next
meeting,
which is
13th.
May 13th.
Yeah.
I want them to hear all of this discussion anyway, so.
Do you want me to put them on the site list? I want to put them.
Yeah.
I want
yeah.
you guys to show up.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
Hopefully it'll be raining, or will have rained the day before.
One reason I'm adamant about this, I'm accosted every time I go to the YMCA by Land Conservation Commission. Trust board members complain about we gave them that land and with the understanding this wasn't going to happen, now things are getting torn apart. And I'm catching hell all the time about it. I said, we've talked about that, we've dealt with it, and apparently we have. So
we haven't dealt with it. We definitely haven't dealt with it. But we have talked about it.
Yeah. So the next easy situation is Dustin Road, all that fill back there. So
didn't we already talk about that?
Yeah, we did.
At the beginning.
At the beginning of the meeting.
Okay. Or, well,
yeah.
so we
were
going
to
continue.
Let's start over. Let's go through the whole agenda
until
again.
Well, it's right there. It's right there. So.
Follow up. That's all. I guess, what do you want that Dustin Road people to do? Have you been invited to the next meeting, or they missed this meeting and they knew they were supposed to be here, send them an enforcement order?
I think if they were invited and they didn't come.
Didn't send you, that I couldn't come,
yeah,
sort of thing.
And they didn't contact you, that's an automatic thumb your nose. Enforcement order. See you later.
Do we know for sure they put this lease in there? I mean, sure as hell looks
it's
like
been,
it.
It's big
unless
pile.
Some good Samaritan.
It's been going on
I'm
for
always,
a long time.
I never know how to answer you because the tree stand thing in the camera. But unless some good Samaritan had some extra fill and saw these depressions in this guy's lawn, I'm pretty sure that he did it himself.
In his lawn?
Yeah.
I don't care what he did in his lawn. In our land.
Well, that's in our buffer zone. That he,
it
that
goes
he
right
did that
into
field.
The water.
That was the whole thing.
I thought it was on our land.
No.
That I saw was on conservation land.
Come in for that?
He did, and then we couldn't see it because there was too much snow, so people were supposed to go out there in the last couple of meetings and look at this, which just has happened.
Which we did.
And he was supposed to come in, we were supposed to find out.
There's a big pile.
Yep, in the back.
On our land.
There's many piles.
And it's not on jurisdictional area as far as I can tell.
It's in buffer.
But it's on our land, that's more, I'm more concerned about that.
No, I think you're thinking about Pine Vale Conservation Area. This is Dustin Road where it's just jurisdictional area.
We typically don't mind if people put leaves in the buffer zone. It's in the jurisdictional areas where we get off.
But the pile is a good dump truck full.
Yeah, it is.
Is it still okay? I mean, I think that's why he's coming in. We need to establish.
We need to understand it.
Yeah, we gotta get some sort of policy, I guess.
I think if you want to have a pile of leaves in your own property, I think it's fine.
No, I don't think it's his property. I think it's actually 364 Lowell Street's property because it swings down around that area.
But
well, then let those people do.
But it's not conservation land. It's private property. If you want to keep leaves there, then more power.
I mean, I have a huge.
It's private property, but it's in a wetland.
Property.
What's
know.
That?
It's private property, but it's in a wetland. And it's within several feet of a wetland.
It's in a wetland, that's a different story.
Yeah,
so well, that area at the end is wet.
I'll be right back.
Okay.
So.
So,
I mean, this kind of discussion is useless. I mean, to me, you guys are supposed to know what's going on so we can talk about it. You're supposed to know that it's a wetland. You're supposed to know that it's fill. You're supposed to know both these guys have been doing it chronically. That's why we have a site visit.
Well,
and then tell me what I'm supposed to do. Am I writing a letter or are we forgetting about it? Because we typically allow, you know, leaves out there. I mean, I don't mind not getting into every single fight with every single person here in the town of Reading. And actually, I don't want to do it if nothing happens. So, we could do other things.
You know, I almost wonder with Dustin Road if we could ask, the 40B... If that 40B project does go through, we start asking them to clean out a lot of that stuff back there. Are we going to ask all of Dustin Road, who's been dragging their leaf waste for years and years and years down to the end of their street and dumping it near the tracks, to go in there and clean it out now? We could. We would have rights to say that. But what's going to stop them from continuing it? And how, you know, it's this whole enforcement piece. How are we going to, you know, should we post a sign, no dumping of leaves?
Yeah, so one of the neighbors called and said, this is a chronic problem. This is happening again. Go down and check it out. So what I saw was the big leaf pile and the fresh fill on both sides and then kind of like some grading. So we have grading, we have fill, we have a leaf pile. Come in, let's tell you that that's not what you're supposed to be doing, some educational piece. That works fine. I mean, he was here, and he was supposed to be here tonight. So why don't I just send him another letter?
He has come in and talked to you about it, you're saying?
Well,
he's
he came into
in
the meeting.
He's come into many meetings.
Oh.
At least two.
He came to the one that was canceled, too.
Yeah.
Because we didn't get him the letter in time. Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
So,
all right. Well, that's different. I thought we
he's
sent
a
letter
resident.
And we'd never seen him, you know?
Yeah.
But he's not the whole street.
I
and
have
he's
a
not.
Form here. I better get it back.
Okay.
Anyway.
Yeah.
So,
letter. Oh, one more, sir.
Okay, so not too passionate about this. Okay. So we could post some signs, or we could just keep asking people to come in. I think if any more yard waste really starts accumulating there, there is going to be no water flow back there. So
Chuck is absolutely right, though. We tend to talk about things and sometimes pass votes and there's no action, there's no follow-up, there's no anything. I think we have a problem. I mean, I'm thinking about the signs at Cassine Field.
Yep.
The
signs by Imagination Station.
tanking up at the, whatever river that is, on Bear Meadow. Never got those guys. The hydroseeders that were tanking up every morning.
Right.
That was
right. They were pumping straight out of a wetland into their,
they can do that. That's legal.
Up to.
It is true. Yeah, it's
so
legal,
these people
but
on Scotland can't pump out their wetland, into the storm drain.
Yeah.
That's the difference.
The thing
that is discharging to a storm
drain. That's
the
isolated wetland. If they pump that water out, it dries up. That's the impact on the wetland. You can pump out of a stream.
Out of a stream, you can.
Gotcha. Okay.
I mean, if you've ever been on Concord, the Sudbury, or any one of those, all of those farms along have intake and pumps.
Yeah, but you don't want every trucker down. That's not a lot of flow there, is? I didn't think it was a lot of flow there.
No, it's not. But I'm sure.
But you don't want every
hydroseeder
in town or in every town coming in.
No.
But I mean, that was the whole discussion. And of course, if they're wrecking the bank, or they're destroying, you know, whatever as they're getting there, you know, who knows? This is a school area with, you know, trucks showing up at 7 o'clock in the morning and disturbing the neighbors. So
where is it happening?
It's in Bear Meadow, right where that.
At the corner of
Castine. Remember where you guys said no one can mow this area?
Yeah.
That's not Bear Meadow.
Castine.
Bear Meadow
Castine.
Road or something like that? Castine?
Castine
Field.
Birch Meadow.
Birch
Meadow.
Birch
Meadow.
Yeah.
Birch Meadow.
So
that's our John River.
Yeah, it is. So I think the only thing that's really going to start prohibiting, like being like a constant reminder for people, are signs that say no dumping. That's like a permanent letter attached over there. Maybe we could get some cooperation from.
What's the fine? What's the fine? We have a fine on it.
Is it $25 fine? We have a fine on bylaw, $25, $50, something like
for
that.
For dumping.
We need to put it up in an order of magnitude or something.
Maybe that's the thing.
I don't know if we do have a fine for dumping. We have a fine for violation of order conditions.
Hold on a second.
We
do.
Could come
we
up
get
with
something. Because when I looked into it, we had to have a fine in order to use the tickets.
Yeah.
I mean, you all these no dumping signs, they usually have signs that usually have fines attached.
I just think, you know, if letters and meetings aren't getting the message out, everybody pays attention to signs.
Mm-hmm.
So getting something posted.
Sign,
not stop
signs. Everywhere signs.
Not stop signs.
Not stop signs.
Worth a try. Unless you're going to get a camera.
It's one of the,
right.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah. It's a practical
solution. We just got money back from that water bill. Can we buy a drone?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Let's buy one of those
drones. Right?
Drone. Just hover it over there the whole time. You are under drone surveillance.
Man.
So, Chuck, do you need us to vote to approve the corrected amount there, or you're just letting us know about the corrected water sewer bill for
Pearl
Street?
Yeah, you can approve it if you. It's a formality.
I move we approve the corrected water bill and.
Is it water
get
or stormwater?
It's water and sewer. It's
storm.
That.
It's the storm water.
It's
the water.
Yeah. Water and sewer. Storm.
It's the water and sewer bill with the stormwater fee included, and so it is the stormwater fee itself. But so I move we approve.
Second it.
All those in favor? Okay.
It looks like the fine would, you'd have to, first step would be to send an enforcement order, and then we have one that says failure to comply with an enforcement order, but it's a big number, $300.
That's right, I remember now.
So when we get
per
to
day.
Per day.
Three in there
per day.
Per day.
Okay,
per day.
So that's.
It is
okay.
That's a killer.
Yeah, it is.
So it is a big number.
Mm.
But we have to send
we have to get
an order first, right?
We have to get to that point, yeah. And I'd like to send the letters first before the enforcement.
Okay. Minutes for approval.
Any
so
objections
any
on minutes?
Objections on minutes? Comments? No? Hearing none, motion to approve minutes.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor? Okay.
Abstaining. I'm abstaining.
Abstaining.
Because I wasn't here.
Okay. Any other topics for people to bring up? Chuck, you're flipping through something.
You guys are signed up for Friends and Family Day.
What is that? June?
It is. It's June.
Coming up. Well, I didn't think I'd do that.
Friends and Family Day?
June 13th, Saturday.
It's a like a fair at Birch Meadow
down
in the fields. Everybody, every committee and a lot of
lots of
a
Italian
lot of stores
ice.
Set
typically
up.
The youngest member and
never
the oldest
been.
Member stays all day.
24 years running.
Oh, you should definitely go.
You've never been.
Never been.
Oh, you should go.
I
it's from
this
11
year,
to 3.
I'm gonna take that street sweeper out for a spin. Every time I walk by that, I'm like, I want to take that out for a spin.
I would.
When is it?
It's a Saturday.
June 13th.
So would everybody spend time around? Is that how it would go?
Yeah, we
informational booths.
We do shifts, yeah, with a table and maybe a turtle or two.
Once or twice.
We'll put it on the May agenda.
I can't go.
I can't
go.
It's my parents' anniversary weekend.
Okay.
So I'm throwing them a party.
Okay.
Are you going to be in town?
No.
Okay.
Otherwise, I would
party
stop
out of
by.
Town.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Fireworks. You must like that.
I honestly I don't think I've ever gone.
It's
or that I can remember that I went. Maybe I went when I was really little.
It's pretty impressive.
It is nice. It is usually a nice day.
Brian was there 2 or 3 years
oh,
ago.
Oh gosh.
With his escort.
This
state police escort.
Yeah.
Any other?
Not when he was running in New Hampshire. When he was running.
No. Right.
Any other agenda?
He's running from Vermont.
Yes, he is.
Bernie Sanders or?
Not hearing none. Motion
Stop
to
round.
Adjourn.
Mm.
Second.
All those in favor. All right.